Okay, 541, Calexico City Council, Calexico Redevelopment Successor Agency, Calexico Financing Authority, regular meeting. 608 Heba Avenue, Calexico, California. Tuesday, May 17, 2016. Call to order. Yes.
Here.
Thank you, Ms. Garcia. The public comments, not to exceed 3 minutes. This is the time for the public to address the City Council on closed session items only. The mayor will recognize you, and when you come to the microphone, please state your name and the place of the residence for the record. While members of the public are encouraged to participate, it is unlawful to disturb or delay the council meeting with personal or slanderous remarks. The City Council is prohibited by the state law from taking action or discussing items not included on the printed agenda. Please direct your questions and the comments to the City Council. Do we have somebody to the come in? Thank you. Adjourn to the closed session. A closed session of the City Council, Calexico Community Redevelopment Agency, Successor Agency, Calexico Financing Authority may be held in accordance with the state law, which may include it, but is not limited to the following type of the items: personal matters, labor negotiations, security matters, providing instruction to real property, negotiators and the conference with legal counsel regarding pending litigation. The closed session will be held in the City Hall conference room located at 608 Heba Avenue, Calexico, California. Any public comment on closed session item will be taken before the closed session. Any required announcements or discussion of closed session items or acting following the closed session will be made in the City Council chambers, 608 Heba Avenue, Calexico, California. Closed session. One, public employee appointment, government code 54957B, title city manager. Two, conference with legal counsel, anticipated litigation, significant exposure to litigation pursuant to government code section 54956.9D2E1, two potential cases. Three, conference with labor negotiators, agency representative, city manager, city attorney, employee organization, police officer association, firefighter association, supervisor association, certified operators association, SEIU, local 221, Calexico Municipal Employees Association, government code section 54957.6. Is anything to hold it? We're gonna adjourn to closed session. 44. To adjust the phone to the nothing ringing during the meeting, please. 6:32. Calexico City Council, Calexico Redevelopment Successor Agency, Calexico Financing Authority, regular session meeting is open. Call to order, Ms. Garcia. Yes.
Here.
Here.
Thank you, Ms. Garcia. And we have Pledge of Allegiance to lead by I think I forgot your name. There, please. the leaders. Closed session announcements.
No reportable actions were taken.
Thank you, Mr. Hargrave. And the approval of agenda, I think we have some adding agenda today about the regular meeting for the following meeting for the elections.
Okay, I think there's a suggestion that we add an item at the end of the agenda to move the date of the first meeting in June till June 8th.
June 8th.
So that we're not meeting on the night of the California primary.
Okay.
Right.
Thank you. So is there any motion to add it? Or we just can add it as a mayor?
You can just, when it comes to adjournment, let's just have that discussion. You can just adjourn it to the 9th, if everyone agrees, or to the 8th. Right.
So we don't have to put we just have to vote then?
You don't have to formally put it on the agenda at this point.
At this point, before the agenda meeting, we can discuss ourselves.
Right.
Thank you. Okay. So where are we going to put on the agenda discussing this one? Maybe before starting the meeting, presentation? Okay, let's start from the after presentation. Announcements. These proceeding may be viewed on the City of Calexico website at www.calexico.ca.gov. The Friday following the City Council meeting. Presentation number four. Proclamation for Immigrant Heritage Month, June 2016. I believe we have a fellow council member have a reading material. We have a motion to approve the agenda. Motion by Ms. Hurtado.
No, so moved.
Second.
Second by Mr. Castro. We have both.
Aye.
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 Thank you, Ms. Hurtado. Okay. Proclamation for the Immigrant Heritage Month, June 2016. Whereas generation of immigrants from every corner of the globe have built our country's economy and create the unique character of our nation and...
Whereas immigrants continue to grow businesses, innovate, strengthen our economy, and create America jobs in Calexico, California, and...
Whereas immigrants have provided the United States with unique social and cultural influences and fundamentally enriching the extraordinary characters of our nation and...
Whereas immigrants have been proud leaders not only in securing their own rights and access to equal opportunity, but have also campaigned to create a fairer and more just society for all of us.
Would you follow up, Mr.
Whereas, despite these countless contributions, the role of immigrants in building and enriching our nation has frequently been overlooked and undervalued throughout history and continuing to the present.
Now, therefore, I, Jung, ask him, Mayor of the City of Calexico, on behalf of the Calexico City Council, do hereby proclaim June 2016 as Immigrant Heritage Month in the City of Calexico. In witness thereof, I hereunto affix my signature and official seal of the City of Calexico on the 17th day of May 2016. Is there anybody come from the entity, Ms. Garcia? No one didn't come? Okay. I think, would you let them know that they come to pick it up? Thank you. Okay, now we have public comments and the public appearance. Note not to exceed 3 minutes. This is the time for the public to address the city council on any item not appearing on the agenda that is within the subject matter jurisdiction of the city council. The mayor will recognize you, and when you come to the microphone, please state your name and the place of residence for the record. While members of the public are encouraged to participate, it is unlawful to disturb or delay the council meeting with personal or slanderous remarks. If the item you wish to comment on is a closed session or a consent item, please comment now. The City Council is prohibited by state law from taking action or discussing item not included on the printed agenda. If the item you wish to comment on is on the public portion of the agenda, we will take your comment when we get to the item on the agenda. Please direct your questions and the comments to the City Council. Okay, we don't have nobody public comment, or we have one person, Javier Gonzalez.
Honorable Mayor, Council members, staff, members of the public, Javier Gonzalez, 237 Hernandez Street. I'm here on behalf of Kennedy Gardens. First thing, it's good news. We'd like to acknowledge that our park, John F. Kennedy, has now full and complete irrigation system. It was a long time that we were bugging you guys, and we kept, but we complain a lot, but we also give credit where credit is due. We want to give credit to the Parks Department, Mr. Victor Felix, Angel Hernandez, and the whole Parks Department and staff of the city. We want to thank them very much for their hard work, and now Kennedy Gardens, John F. Kennedy Park, is full with full and complete irrigation system. Just one thing, summer is coming, and I believe city manager stated that we're going to open the water at least twice, Tuesday, Thursdays, and Saturdays. It's going to be hot. We got small trees out there, and we don't want them to, you know, to have a hard trouble growing through the summer. Second, we just had a memory tree planting event this Saturday. It was very successful, very emotional. I want to thank Mayor Yung Kim for being there, and I want to thank Gabby Garcia and Eric Alacuesta for that nice and beautiful certificates. They're better than the proclamations. I mean, I just read them and it broke my heart. I knew those two ladies. They were part of our community. That is wonderful. Kennedy Gardens is almost full of trees. Now, John Renison just committed to 20 trees where we want to plant along Highway 111. We do need some water, at least drip irrigation to every tree, something we're going to work with our city manager. The next thing I want to comment is an article that came out in the Adelante Valle this Friday, and it's quoting me on a page that I have, Calexico Proyecto Kennedy, where I talk about the rumors about closing the police department. It's very, very clearly that I say that I support my police department, and I am not in support of bringing in the sheriff's department. And the page is kind of confusing, but I reposted it, I don't blame the newspaper, but I do support our police department completely. All our officers, in the 18 years that I've been a neighborhood watch captain, by the way, the only neighborhood watch captain in the valley. If you go to the National Neighborhood Watch, there's only one person there, and it is us. And we've never, never made any complaints or take any side between any officers. It's not our job to say who's the good, the bad, or the ugly. We like them all. The final thing is, as president of the finance commission, we're very upset that you guys appointed us, especially you, Mr. Castro. You appointed me to the Finance Commission, and most of the things that come to us are before the fact. We have very competent person. We have Mr. Yanez with a doctorate degree. I will have a master's degree. We have a CPA. And every time there's a finance issue, we're always left at the end. We're here to advise you guys. So if you're not going to send anything to us, why come to the meetings? Why be appointed? Might as well resign. So if there's things, I know there's emergencies, those things we understand, but most of the things, we gave direction to our finance director, and our representative on this matter will be Mr. Alex Peroni. We wanna be able to discuss and give you advice on things that are related to finance. Everyone in that commission is capable, has the education, the qualifications to do that. Another thing is council member appointments. You have one council member that hasn't appointed anybody, and they can't be going up there representing themselves. The policy, the city code is very clear. They can represent their appointee when he's absent, but not be up there, not appoint nobody and be up there showing up to every meeting. That's not the proper way to run our commissions. We hope that you fill out commissions. If council members cannot appoint, the council should appoint. They have 45 days to appoint if one council member does not appoint. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Mr. Gonzalez. I think there's only one person wants to talk with a general comment. The other person, 11, 13, and 16. So if they have no more general comment, we're going to conclude the public comment, then we're going to go to City Council comment. Okay, Mr. Leal, are you ready?
I have no comment.
You have no comment? Thank you. Ms. Hurtado?
The representatives representing the U.S. Commercial Services Department of Commerce, I apologize if that's not going to be here. Just last week, I had a visit. Mr. Tim Kelly represents the Imperial Valley Economic Development Corporation. And on May the 10th, they came. I own a business in downtown Calexico. I've been a tax preparer and an immigration consultant for almost 30 years. And they were visiting Calexico downtown, especially to find out our opinion of what's been going on lately. Now that the federal government has cracked down so difficultly on our banks, and that we lost so many banks in our area. And the two gentlemen were Aaron Davidson and Scott Schmidt from, again, the U.S. Commercial Services Department of Commerce. And the reason that they were out here was because they do care, they want to know what our opinion is and how we are actually surviving in the city of Calexico with no banks. Being in the downtown area, I've lived there practically all my life for almost 30 years working there, and you see the different decades, I guess, of commerce and activity in the downtown area. And of course, at this period of time, it's very, very sad, and not having any resources as far as banking makes it sadder. You didn't time me. Anyhow, the interesting conversation was about what is it that we do to survive? What is it that businesses do in Calexico to actually then continue to do business and continue to do business at a profit? And so we had a great conversation. It looks like they'll be working together with our congressman to continue this conversation and to continue to insert themselves into this community and find a solution for us. Personally, I'm making changes in my business to increase the different services that we provide in downtown, specifically ATM machines. It's as simple as that, to be able to provide some ATM machines to the customers. So not only are we going to survive this, we're going to have to reinvent ourselves as business owners. So we learned a lot at that meeting, and I'm glad that they came to visit. It was a perfect timing, especially because I am right now within making those changes, because I know that we do rely quite a bit on our neighbors to the south for us to survive. So if those customers are coming to this city for the Walmart that we have, which is number one in sales, then they're coming here for a reason. And they definitely cannot do finances and mail services and things like that in their own country in Mexico. They've got to come over here and do that kind of business. So as business owners, I recommend that you also try to think outside the box. We're stuck here right now for a good while without banks. Doesn't make it any easier. But hang in there. There's people out there that do care, and I'll just keep you posted as far as further developments with regard to the visits and any further assistance to make our situation better. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms. Hurtado. Mr. Castro?
No comments at this.
You no comments this time?
This time.
Okay, then looks like my turn. Okay, I had some requests from the Los Amigos president to help bring the some, give them some prize for the raffle. So I went to Los Amigos, Grupo Amigos, the Mother's Day party I was presented at. And they were announcing all the candidates for the election for the IID. And except me, they didn't recognize my name. Even they, I'm the mayor, I was presented it, and they were not mentioning the mayor who was here. When they were talking of the prize, even they not consider calling me, just say the Jun Kim brought the raffle. And of course, it's not the fault from the Amigos group, the person who's doing the MEMC, and those Gompa groups to involve them in politics, they are the one guilty of this, all those crazy movements. And those kind of mentality, that coward, the mentality is making the collective worse. And I believe the citizen has to stand up to against those kind of the discriminations and to fight for the everybody's right, not some one person or some one group's right. And also, I believe I was presented on the Kennedy Gardens, the ceremony for the memory of the trees. And plus, finally, I'm glad to Kennedy Garden concluded about the sprinkler. But I believe there's so many different areas to taking care of it. Not only Kennedy Garden, several places under our park still is forgotten. And our city, our council members' the job is to make the right decision to help the city to we can provide the right service for the community. But unfortunately, those three wrong vote to supporting the wrong administration, not only last a couple of years only, what I understand in the last 20 years in the history of Calexico, those three votes of the council lead us to today's chaos. Every council, they raise the debt. That's what we have in the shrinking our revenue, because the debt we have to pay, make the payments. And plus, we make the wrong decision. We're spending so much money in wrongly in different areas. And I believe citizens have to wake up to pushing council member right decision and elect the right council members. And we fail to elect the right council member, that's why we are facing now today. A couple months ago, probably about 10 months ago, so many people, over 200 people, were there supporting the bad administrations and forcing us to approve the bad contract. We were lucky to manage it. If not, we're going to be, even we're not going to be able to talk about how bad we are, because everything is going to be hidden. So please be aware, our citizens, whatever here today is council's responsible, but it's not only that. As a city, whole city community has to have a better involvement in the politics. They have to be watching the elected person doing it. Thank you. Okay, city manager's report.
Nothing to report at this time.
Thank you. Okay, we have a consent agenda. Is anybody wants to pull? 5-9. Nobody wants to pull the item. If nobody has wants, nobody
I'd
has.
Like to pull number 7, please.
Which one?
Number 7.
Number 7. So who's gonna make the motion to approve it? Do we have a motion to approve? Rest of them, 5, 6, 8, 9.
Motion to approve 1 to 5, except 7.
5, 6, 8, 9.
Second.
Second by Mr. Real. Sherry Boat? Yes?
Aye.
Aye.
Mr. Aye. Thank you. 4-0 and 1 absent. Okay, number 7, Ms. Hurtado.
This is the company that the City of Calexico was required to hire, I believe, as a third-party claims administrator once we switched over to the different insurance carrier that we have now. But I remember that this group, the third-party claims administrator, should have been appointed since the 1st of February. Are we switching now? Because I never knew who the first company was going to be. So is this a different one?
No, it's the same one. However, for some reason, this resolution wasn't included on the original item that was brought to you back in February. Once the first claim came in, we realized that this hadn't taken place. So that's why I'm being brought before you today.
Okay, so this is still the same company. It's just that we lack to have filed the resolution.
That's correct.
Okay, motion for its approval.
Thank you, Ms. Hurtado. Motion by Ms. Hurtado. Do we have a second?
Second.
Second by Mr. Castro. Sherry Boat. Aye.
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 Thank you. Okay, now discussion and the potential action items. Number 10, general fund update and the development of a financial workout plan. Before we start, I think we're going to need to discussion about the postponing the moving the meeting date for the June 7th to the June 8th. Because due to elections?
No, let's have that discussion at the end, at the time of adjournment.
That would be
the time to have that discussion.
Okay, thank you. Mr. Mayor?
Good evening, Council. Is my microphone on?
Yes.
Yes, thank you. My name is Susan Mayer. I'm a financial consultant that's been working with your finance team to reconstruct your accounting and financial records for the past. I've actually been here for 10 months now. I'm here tonight to give you a general fund update and also to start the financial planning process for the next fiscal year. Sort of the overall theme for my message tonight is creating a sustainable financial plan going forward. One of the most important policy decisions in front of the City Council is the decision as to how to allocate the resources that are available, particularly in the general fund, which is where you receipt your discretionary tax dollars. Despite many, many requests from this council for data about the status of your general fund for the fiscal year, the accounting systems have simply not been in place to give you good information to make informed policy decisions. And I'm here tonight to tell you that the fog is clearing. It's been 7 months since you installed a new finance team and that your accounting staff has been reconstructing their records. And we are pleased to be almost through clear with the 14-15 audit. And so now we are turning our attention to 15-16. And so our objective tonight is to give you information about 15-16, but also to start the planning process for the 16-17 fiscal year. We're hoping to set the stage for you to consider the policy options available for you to allocate your resources. Do we have a projector there? Yes. As we consider a sustainable financial plan, some of the points that I hope we can cover tonight are, what are the revenues that are available for you to provide your municipal services? What is the cost of services for your current workforce with your current salary and benefit structure? What is the status of the general fund? And finally, we'd like to talk about what steps are necessary to finance the period of time until you can work into a balanced budget, because unfortunately we're in a situation where your existing revenues are not covering the cost of services. I'll continue while they're working on the PowerPoint. I was last here in front of you 2 months ago. I was here in the middle of March, and I'd like to just brief you on their progress since that time. We are completing the 2015 financial audit. I wanted to remind you of an important assumption we made when we reported the 15 results to you, We showed you that we had a path to a balanced budget, a balanced fund, balanced general fund for 14-15, with the key assumption that the City Council would be willing to draw from their Measure H bond proceeds to fund capital improvements that had been spent in 2014 and 15. There were a number of issues in the 14-15 year, including some major misassumptions on the revenues and some unexpected costs. And as a result, we were in a situation where the general fund had overspent its revenues for the 14-15 fiscal year. At that time, in March, we briefed you that we had a path to balancing the budget if the council agreed to draw money from its Measure H bond proceeds, and the specific number was $678,000. That formal request and resolution is on your agenda tonight. I understand that there is concern about this recommendation, and it may not have received support from the Measure H committee. I wanted to remind the council that this is an important step in completing the 14-15 audit. Without that resolution, we are unable to balance your budget, and you would have been in an overdraft situation at June 2015. Since the Measure H money is discretionary, the council has within its policy authority to draw those funds. And so I just wanted to alert you, because that is a following that you will come up across that agenda item on the agenda tonight. Without that resolution, we are unable to give you a balanced budget for June 2015, and we are unable to start the 15-16 conversation at zero. And so I encourage you to thoughtfully consider that policy to draw the bond proceeds to, again, funding the capital improvements from the general fund from 13-14 and 14-15. The other news on the audit is that the auditors have proposed no adjustments to the general fund. The time that it took to clean the records has proved fruitful, and we feel we have solid numbers for you now for the 14-15. The federal audit is still in progress, but again, the staff has worked well through that audit process. One of the other important things that has happened since I was last with you is we have set up the insurance funds for the city's new self-insurance programs. And I've often asked, what are some of the conditions that created the financial disarray in your accounting department? And one of them is that shortcuts were taken as to how you were recording your self-insurance programs. And the city actually has 5 self-insurance programs. You are self-insured for workers' compensation, general liability, health, dental, and unemployment. There are actually 5 different programs. And what was happening is, as these costs were being paid, they were not being charged out to the departments. And so your staff has taken some time to set up accounting processes and funds so that we can inquire and look at the status of those programs. But most importantly, your payroll system is now automatically charging the departments every pay period for a workers' comp rate and a health rate so that you can capture real costs as you go. Many people have asked why we can't simply print reports to find out what the status of the general fund, and it's because the data has not been credible, because these costs have not been set up to automatically charge. That, I think, is a great progress by your accounting team. We have started looking at the 15-16 fiscal year. I'm pleased to tell you that we're fully now in the Springbrook General Ledger system. Just in the last 2 weeks, they have caught up 6 months of cash receipts postings. And so despite the time it has taken, again, the fog is clearing, and we're really now just able to see the real status of the 15-16 fiscal year. We are also looking ahead to the 16-17 fiscal year. Your payroll and your HR staff have teamed together and come up with an incredibly detailed cost projection of the salary and benefit structure that the city currently is paying to its employees. And they have put together the cost projection to give you information about what it's costing to run each of your program departments. Focusing on 15-16, we have challenges with the June 2015 spending plan that was presented to you. And I'm carefully not calling this a budget. Eduardo, we're on slide 4 at this time. A proposed budget was presented to the City Council last June, and the budget was not accepted by the council and was not adopted, but we still refer to it as a spending plan that envisioned how resources might be allocated. The deeper we dig into it, we are realizing that there are issues. as what happened in 14-15, the Measure H revenues and resources were overstated. The general liability costs were significantly understated. In January, you changed insurance providers, and as a result, you are faced with 18 months of insurance costs within a 12-month period. And you've also had some additional one-time costs related to the investigation in the police department and also your executive turnover.
Mrs. Mayor, just to stop you real quick. You're talking about the budget that Mr. John Quinn and Richard Warren gave the council, correct?
And so I'm calling it a spending plan since it wasn't formally adopted. The council did not accept it.
That's the one where the Measure H was double counted.
The Measure H revenues were double counted in 14-15.
Correct.
And they were also, the Measure H resources were also overestimated in the 15-16 spending plan.
Okay, thank you.
And so a plan was put in place, decisions were made based on the assumption that more resources were available than actually were available. The other item, the other challenge we're facing in 15-16 is the risk in your housing programs. You're still under audit by the feds for some of your housing programs. You have four staff that are being allocated to these housing funds. However, your federal grants are frozen, and we don't have operating budgets to cover the administrative costs of the housing program. So there are a number of significant risks. And again, I'm talking about the 15-16 fiscal year as portrayed in the spending plan presented for the fiscal year in June of 2015. We've assembled our best available projection for how we think the city will, the general fund will end in 15-16 by June of 2016. And before I go into that, I want to just talk about the process we used to come up with this. We have 10 months of payroll paid. We projected and extrapolated for the last two months of the year. We have paid our accounts payable vendors for 10 months of the year, although those bills are often a month in arrears. And so we have done broad strokes estimates to best estimate what the remaining costs are for the fiscal year. This is by no means a projection of an actual balance or even a compiled or an audited balance. It's the best available information that we have. I would say the most significant drivers are the items I just mentioned before, the overestimated revenues, the liability insurance budgeting challenge, the 18 months of the insurance program, and also the risk in the housing funds. And our best estimate at this time is that your revenues will fall short of expenditures by $3 million. This is very late in the year to be giving you this information. And again, I must credit the council for the many countless times they have asked for updated financial information. And my best answer to you is that we are just now seeing credible information about what the real costs have been for the general fund. And so now we have a situation where we have information and we need to consider our options to positively move forward to create a balanced spending plan in the future and come up with a workout plan to address the deficit that to be repaid over time. And so $3 million is our estimated issue for 15-16.
Ms. Mayor, can I ask you a question? Maybe, I don't know if Eduardo could answer. Can you guys recall the last time the council got a quarterly report? How many years ago that was? Was it back in 2012, 13, 14? It's at least been over 2 years that the council doesn't get any quarterly report, correct? Okay, so, all right.
The last formal report was given in June 30th, 2015. Remember
based
we talked
on,
about.
Based
remember
on
remember
the,
we talked about that one, Eduardo, the one that wasn't in the, and I gave you a copy, the one that was presented out at that one meeting.
That was a report, that was a report based on the fake budget that was given to us.
That's,
so
that's
I'm talking about
that's
when
not
was
the official report. That is official comic books. That's a whole wrong number. Just paste the copy and paste the numbers. So actually, we had the
hold
number.
Hold on. I would like a report on when the last actual financial report was given to the council, please.
Actually, was called the financial report, quarterly report, was stopped by, I believe, 2014, because that
even the quarterly report we had, it all wrong number. I was challenging every time they stopped to bring in to the council meeting.
My understanding was the last time we got a court, the council got a quarterly report, I wasn't even here. It was when Oscar Rodriguez was here. That's the last city manager that gave us a financial report. But go ahead and check and make sure. Thank you.
Periodic financial reports to the city council are important, and they are possible only when the accounting data is being properly recorded so that the information is credible. Right? To print reports is not sufficient unless there is quality control behind those numbers. And I cannot emphasize enough the progress your staff has made incrementally by rebuilding processes that have not been in place for a long time. This is our projection. This is where we are. This is an unfortunate situation, but we have a recommendation as to how we move forward. We are recommending an interfund borrowing before June 30. We have discussed this with your attorneys, and they are recommending a type of lease arrangement. Did you know that the California Constitution does not allow cities to borrow money without a vote of the people? Except cities borrow money all the time. And how do they do that? They do that through a lease arrangement. And this is how most cities issue what are called COPS bonds, certificates of participation. This is not an enviable situation to be in, but we want to keep the city solvent and in compliant with the government code. The government code does not allow you to borrow money or to write checks or to be in a deficit by the end of the fiscal year. And so during the next 30 days, 45 days, we would like to work with you to create a financial plan going forward to rebalance your budget for next year, demonstrate an ability to repay an interfund loan, and formalize documents in the form of a lease to borrow the money to allow you to end the fiscal year compliant with the government code. We cannot emphasize enough that it's important for you as city council and for your officials to take the steps necessary to do a formal borrowing for any deficit that might materialize by the end of the year. And so a key component, a key assumption in interfund borrowing will be the ability to repay. And this is where we get back to you as a council setting financial policy. And this is where we'd like to move forward to the discussion of the next fiscal year, the resources in terms of revenues that will be available to you, and start the discussion on what it costs to support your current service and to... we'd like to move forward to the discussion to the next fiscal year to discuss the resources that are available for you to make policy decisions and to give direction to staff to how you choose to allocate your scarce resources to the programs that you most value. This is, again, the council's philosophy and policy. This is the first opportunity we've had to have this discussion with you as to how you would like to prioritize the resources that are available to you. The next slide that I have for you
I have one question.
Yes.
So, in other words, we're running $3 million in the red.
Our best information today, not final, but our best estimate.
So we're $3 million in the red, but we're running skeleton crews in pretty much every single area of our city. With that said, that would mean that if we were actually up to staff, we would be running, maybe $6 million in the red? Have you guys kind of calculated that? If you were to hire the appropriate staffing for every department, if we're $3 million now, it's probably close to $6 million. Is that correct? All right. All right, thank you.
The slide that I have in front of you is not a new slide. This is the same slide we showed to you in March that gives you an estimate of the general fund revenues. And over the past years, there has been confusion about whether or not your general fund revenue includes or excludes your Measure H sales tax. And consistent over the past few years, without the Measure H revenue, you're in the $14 million range for revenues. With the Measure H, you're in the $17 million of revenues. And really, this number is driven by two main items, property tax and sales tax. There are many other smaller revenues, but those are the two big hitters.
Can you repeat that? The largest income for the city is sales tax and property tax, correct?
Yes. Both of them are approximately $5 million a year, give or take. And collectively, they comprise about $10 million or two-thirds
of the general fund. This is about 70% of our general fund?
Correct.
Okay.
These are the projections that we put together in March. Next week, your sales tax consultant, HDL, will be here at the city to make a presentation to your staff with updated projections. So there might be some news there. Your business license for the year, I think, is tracking a little bit ahead of this projection. But regardless, this is the scope of revenues. Before we make a final recommendation to 16-17 for you, we would update this revenue projection. But this gives you the scope that we're talking about with Measure H, $17 million. The next slide is going to show you the cost of your current services.
May I just ask a question with regard to revenues? Mm-hmm. I can see, I believe what I'm seeing here with regard to the revenues for business licenses is that because we have the reduction in our fees and I think then that's why we're looking at a totally different revenue amount, $788,975 for 14-15, and we're looking at a reduction of down to $475 for 15-16, and the same amount for the following. That is recognizing the fact that we reduced the business license fee, so it's about $500,000. No, about $300,000. But the other fee that we reduced that was pretty big was our impact fees for developers. Where are we reflecting that loss of income here on your chart?
It's a very good question, and you're dead on correct with the business license change. The impact fees are a restricted revenue, and your general fund is where you report your discretionary monies. And so each of your development impact fees has a dedicated fund to provide accountability over that fee. You are accountable to the developers who pay the fees to be sure that that money is only spent on the programs that were designed in the Nexus study that created the fee. So development impact fees are recorded in a separate fund for each fee, and they are outside the general fund. They aren't available to pay for police and fire and other discretionary services.
Have we also taken into consideration that reduction wherever then we are posting the revenues for that fund? Was that also adjusted then wherever it is that we're posting then the revenues for the impact fees, as you say, restricted funds? Are we also considering in that area the same impact? In other words, have we taken that step to also consider that loss of income?
Development fees are very cyclical, depends on when developments hit. And so generally those revenues are not budgeted because you only plan and spend them when they arrive. And so there's less of a science to budgeting development impact fees. It depends on what development hits in any particular fiscal year. The general municipal practice is to be very conservative with impact fee projections.
Okay, thanks.
The next slide I'd like to show you is the cost of your current workforce. And I want to emphasize current. One of the council members before referred to what would be an ideal or target or appropriate staffing level. That's a subjective call. What we're reporting to you now is for your existing workforce. Citywide, you have 144 employees on the payroll. 111 of those are in the general fund. 33 are paid for restricted funds, primarily water and wastewater, but also housing, gas tax, and a few others. But primarily when we talk about the general fund revenue that you have to allocate, your current workforce is 111 people, and that costs in next year's dollars, using next year's benefit rates, next year's PERS rates, workers' comp, health, we're projecting $13 million. And so of your general fund of 14.5, $13 million would be consumed just keeping the current workforce as it's currently paid. And I want to show you the allocation on the right column here. Adding police and fire together, public safety is consuming and is committing 71% of the total. And this is fairly typical across the state to have public safety in the 70s percentage of the general fund. I'd like to focus on the police projection here. There's often interest in the number of officers that are available and staffed. And I've heard many people quote many different numbers. This projection relies on 26 sworn officers, of which five are the chief, the lieutenants, and the sergeants. So we're talking about 21 officers. 26 sworn, 21 officers, and they are various different levels of officers classifications. But in total of the 42 police department employees, We have 26 sworn. There's non-sworn, and there's also, this also includes the traffic and the animal control functions that are administered by the police department. And so we have a situation here where we have the existing workforce consuming almost all of your general fund revenues. I would like to also point out on the bottom, I've shown you the average cost of a public safety employee, and this includes benefits. Your benefit load citywide is about 40%, and this pays for the health, the PERS, and other benefits as well. The average cost is $133,000 for a public safety officer, and about $100,000, $98,000 for a non-safety employee citywide. So again, this is data to inform you on your resource allocation options for 16-17. Moving on to the next chart, we'd like to put together and connect the dots between the available revenues and the cost of services. I have three columns here. There is a heightened sensitivity to the Measure H revenue source. You have an advisory committee who is set to advise you on how you spend those funds. However, I think it's appropriate that we look at both the general fund and also the combined general fund and Measure H funds so that you can see the full range of discretionary monies that are available to the city. And so here we have a general fund with $14 million of revenues, $13 million of salaries and benefits, and then we get to the next line, which I'd like to hover on for a minute, operations. Our best estimate, and this is using broad strokes estimates, is that you have about $5 million in operating costs. What are these costs? They are everything from electricity, fuel for your fire trucks and your police cars. They are, this pays for, every department has operating costs. It pays for, in the finance department, it pays for your financial system, it pays for your audit. It pays for your contract services, including your contract attorney. There are many departments that have operating costs other than employee costs. Our best broad stroke estimate is that this is about $5 million. This has not yet been validated by your program departments. The finance staff has sent out detailed budget worksheets to your departments to gather this information. Right now, so for planning purposes, we're using a broad stroke estimate of $5 million. And where do we get that number? Our projection for 15-16 is $5.7 million. We think that perhaps at least a half million of that were one-time costs. And so we're projecting closer to $5 million. You know, the other largest item here that I want to emphasize, this is where your general liability costs are, which are well in excess of $1 million as well. If you put together a repayment plan for the deficit from 15-16, and again, this isn't a recommendation, it's just a placeholder. If you were to choose to, if your deficit is $3 million, and if you choose to repay it over 3 years, we would need to include a placeholder of $1 million each year plus interest to retire that debt. The Measure H bond payment is $1 million each year. We do have reimbursements that lighten the picture a little bit. The Measure H fund has been authorized to be used for salaries, $1.2 million in each of the last several years. In addition, you have your police department is very successful in identifying grants. You have state COPS grants. There's also the Prop 172 money. You have other grant programs as well, and as I understand it, the asset forfeiture program is starting to receive revenue again after a hiatus, and so we have some opportunities there to allocate overtime as well. So there will be reimbursements from the police grants and these other funds. Last year, for 14-15, the city implemented an indirect cost allocation plan and assigned overhead to your utility funds and your other funds. And so collectively, this reimburses almost $2 million of costs back to the general fund. And so again, we're starting to paint the picture here for you to give you the range of motion that you have within the general fund. But unfortunately, this projection, and I'm calling this a baseline projection, this is not a proposed budget. This is a baseline projection before we present and ask for your feedback on solutions to balance the budget. But the bottom line is that you have collectively, including your Measure H funds, approximately $2 million gap to fill, and that's with your existing staffing, and this does not include the resources to restore many desired positions, including public safety. And so for the 16-17, the best information we have is that we will operate a $2 million deficit, including, and half of that, I want to remind you, is the repayment of the deficit from 15-16. It is important that the city build reserves. Operating with nothing in the general fund is a precarious place to be. Nobody is that good at their revenue and their expenditure projections. You need a cushion to prevent the situation to happen again. And we will recommend over a series of years that you do build up a reserve, a rainy day fund. This is where we we call the question, and we say that this is your opportunity to prioritize the resources that you have and to build a sustainable budget. And while we have, and while this plan is being developed, we are unfortunately late in the year and look like we are on path to overspend $3 million, which will need to be repaid over the next few years. In order to borrow that money from the other funds, we need a demonstrated ability to repay, which means balancing the budget going forward, including the repayment of that loan. If you take the Measure H off the table, I've heard opinions expressed that we want to preserve those Measure H dollars for other purposes. And again, I'm talking about the current sales tax. I'm not talking about the bond proceeds here. I'm talking about the current sales tax, which is about 2.7 a year. If you don't include the Measure H, the ability to deliver services declines even further. And so the recommendation is for council to consider their options in balancing the budget and restoring a fund balance reserve, and that we have 45 days to work together with you to get your input on that process and to come up with a balanced budget before the start of the new fiscal year.
I have some question about the number 5. They have the franchise fees have been shrinking, almost $200,000 shrinking. Is what was caused the franchising fees for the shrinking to $200,000?
I believe that in 13-14, there was a one-time correction from the franchise fees that are collected from your solid waste operation. I think that that was a one-time exception and does not represent an ongoing source.
So it's not ongoing source, it's just one-time source. Okay, and the other one is, when we see the major tax, it was 13-14 was $2.5 million. I believe Major H and the sales tax, they go same ratio because Major H's taxes come from the sales tax, same from the part of the sales tax. And 14-15, we increased the sales tax of about $4.6 million, but our revenue is increased the sales tax, I mean the H money 2.7. Next year, 15-16, we projecting our sales tax revenue $4.7 million, and at the bottom, and Major H tax is shrinking. So sales tax is getting bigger. We supposed to have Major H tax supposed to be going bigger too. They're shrinking. Is there some reason there?
Yes. I think you are correct that in the future, it's a reasonable assumption to believe that these numbers will move together. Unfortunately, for the past, since 2004, we've had what's called the triple flip. The state had a budget situation in which they had to issue economic recovery bonds, and so they implemented a sales tax triple flip, is what the name was. And so the 1% sales tax, the Bradley Burns portion of the sales tax, has been coming to you 75% directly from the Board of Equalization, but 25% has been based on an estimate by the Department of Finance in advance. And again, this was because the state took 25% of your Bradley Burns sales tax, leveraged it against the bonds, and then backfilled it from a in-lieu property tax. And so there have been fluctuations from year to year in the sales tax revenue because of the state estimation process. Every year they estimate and then they true it up in a later year based on your actual results. In addition, in the current fiscal year, 15-16, we're unwinding. The state paid off their bonds. And so you have a one-time pickup and benefit as the program continues to unwind. But you are correct, going forward, you would, can expect these two to move together. Because of the state triple flip, the sales tax has not been consistent in the past years.
So they finished by last year?
Yes.
Okay, thank you. So that's why we have more sales tax coming up higher, but the major is not impacting there. Thank you. So I thought we're going to have a balanced budget. I've been about 2 months ago, I've been having a report from the city manager. We are balanced for this year, 15-16. But unfortunately, we're going to have about $2 million short.
I believe there has been confusion about which fiscal year. When I came to you in March and reported on the positive news, I think even the media misreported it as being a report on 15-16, when in fact the report for March reported a balanced budget for 14-15, not for 15-16. There's been confusion about which fiscal year we've been in.
Okay, so it was balanced budget for the 14-15, but not the 15-16. But I believe that you were asking about $600,000-$700,000 from the major bond to balance the budget for the 14-15.
That is correct.
So it's not balanced the 14-15 yet?
The books have been compiled, assuming that the City Council would ratify that resolution. If they choose a different policy direction, then we do not have a balanced budget for 14-15.
Thank you. But I believe we have some responsibility for the community to major tax not using as a balanced budget. There's only we can direct to safety and parks and recreations. That's we are entitled to that bond. But legally, I believe that's a general fund too.
It's a policy choice as to whether you tap the the agenda item that you have later on your agenda tonight proposes a bond draw of $678,000. The expenditures are capital in nature. They are eligible for the bond draw. It is a policy choice as to whether the council uses that method to balance its 14-15 or not.
I'd love to be able to hear. I thought that was very interesting. Can you tell us a bit more the thought process behind why you recommend that way?
And I'm sorry, the microphone is not clear and I have not heard your question.
I found it very interesting the manner in which you recommended to solve and where it was coming from. And so I understand now why you were recommending it that way myself, but can you tell us a little bit about your thoughts, why you felt that that was a good idea to solve it that way, and why Measure H and why that one account?
The city has very few discretionary resources available to it. The whole purpose of the general fund is to consolidate your discretionary resources. In fact, the Government Accounting Standards Board doesn't allow you to have other funds that basically shelter or set aside unrestricted monies. Other funds are designed to be restricted. You have very few choices ahead of you to balance 14-15. The capital expenditures that we had to go back 2 years to find enough capital expenditures to tap that resource. But you asked the process that we went through to find it. You really had very little room to maneuver in order to balance the general fund, because you had a large number of unexpected expenses in 14-15 related to your police investigations. The money was gone, the money was spent. There was no opportunity to recover before the books were closed for the year and to balance the budget. So this was simply a way of tapping into the bond proceeds. Now, those bonds were issued for a fire station, a swimming pool, and park improvements. And so a policy was set in place when those bonds were issued. However, they are discretionary, and the council has the ability to update that recommendation and that allocation in order to meet the terms of the day. The money has been spent, and we need a way to solve that problem. Fortunately, $678,000 is a minor amount of those bond proceeds. It's actually interestingly split half between fire apparatus and park improvements, which are the items, the programs that the bonds were intended for. But it is entirely a policy choice if that is your choice to draw that bond proceeds.
But the council approved the last time that we're going to bring the $1 million to the pay to swimming pool for the school district that supposedly touched from the major H bond. Now we're talking about the $800,000 more from the major H bond to participating to balance the budget.
And so this is the concept we presented in March to the board. There was no formal resolution put in front of you to ratify that. And that's on your agenda tonight to be sure that step is taken so that the council has the formal process to approve or not approve that action.
Another question also. Please let us know, our major H funds are not depleted, correct?
At 1415, the Measure H funds are fully depleted. The revenues were overcommitted in the 1415 budget and also overestimated in the 1516 spending plan. There are no additional current Measure H revenues available.
When I looked at the fund balance report, there's two Measure H areas.
When I looked at the fund balances for Measure H, I saw two different areas. I saw one, the CIP, and then the regular.
That's
so, correct? Okay, so as far as there being fund available right now in the present today, in 2016, the Measure H continues to receive revenues. Is there expenses occurring at this time under our Measure H account?
In providing you an estimate of your 15-16 deficit of $3 million, that projection assumes that you fully deplete and apply your current Measure H revenues to current services.
Wow. So that means the City of Calexico 14-15 budget, they make it a double counting as a major money as a general fund, and also they are implementing as a major H. So we are almost $3 million, so over budgeting. To we can make the by the book by the number we can make the balance.
So I have a question, because how sure are you of these numbers, like 99.9, 99.8? Because some council members tend to think, you know, they're preliminary.
They are preliminary. They're the best available information. But your property tax comes twice a year, and you already have that money. Your sales tax comes monthly, and you have most of that
information.
So you say
we're 95%, 99%.
So we don't have the final numbers, and you won't have your final sales tax numbers until September. City government is a heck of a way to run a business. You don't know your revenues until after you've already spent your money for the year. You don't know your final revenue numbers until the State Board of Equalization gives you your sales tax numbers in the middle of September. Yet you've had to award contracts, pay employees, schedule shifts on the assumption that the revenues will materialize. So they are estimates, but it's the best available information.
So it could change. We could have money. there's a chance, right?
Absolutely.
So right now, I think it's should not use this language, but we are City of Calexico, so jodido.
I didn't understand his comment.
Jodido.
Yeah, City of Calexico, jodido. Yes, our budget is all screwed up.
But improving.
Someone has to be responsible on this, and even though among the council. That it's a shame. It's showing the numbers, double numbers, to flaw to the community to make the balance. It looks like we have balanced the budget, but we're spending and spending. Now everything in the print in the book, right now we found out it was the wrong numbers. We've been lost. It's last year, 14-15 itself, we overspent $13.5 million. During the last administrations, that pumping out all our reserve is gone, all the major money spent
Even we reserve the money for the swimming pool, we spend it. Even we have a minus right now. And we're going to be negative on this year again because we've been spending a lot early beginning of the 15-16. So now we see the next year is going to be another negative, around $3 million of negative. Is that we, how are we going to balance the budget? And we don't have any reserve.
I think what Kim's, I speak Kimanese a little bit, so I think what he's trying to say is that I remember somebody holding a budget in there saying, this is a balanced document. We were lied to, all of us, including the council. Remember, we're up here, but we only know, we're only as good as the information they give us. And, you know, I myself got kicked out of the finance office for asking some questions. And, you know, we were lied to. I don't know if that's something that's, I mean, criminal. It should be, because you're really working with the people's money. I mean, the taxpayers' money, and to tell us everything's fine. You know, go ahead and approve our contracts. Everything's fine. There's money. This is a balanced document right here. Everything's good. Don't worry about it. We're in the clear. And then we find this out. I mean, now that this is actual numbers. I mean, it's very tough up being up here and making decisions based on numbers that are fake, and that's just unfortunate what has happened to us. But you know, we all drank the punch. We all wanted those people to be saviors of our city, but it is what it is. And now we're gonna have to, you know, figure out what to do. Did I translate it right?
Mostly, yes.
Oh, all right.
Now you don't have to talk to the Koreans to understand that. And our budget is all lie to the community. This is a fraud from the administration. And Mr. Leal was saying is we are all fooled by the administration, but there was several areas signal to that budget or the financial report is false. Well, every time when I bring it, they stop me, or even they try to remove him from the chamber, call the police chief to remove him from the chamber, not to talk, to make sure the public doesn't know about that information. That's been happening in the last couple of years. There's some, where you see it, they always have a signal to, it's a flood, the council didn't want to see it. That's a problem we had. After we removed the administration, now we're talking about the real number. As the book was over years, it's not been consolidated. We spent a lot of time, effort to put the every number in right place, and now we can become the real numbers. Probably maybe a little change it, but almost like the same. We are fooled by administration, we are fooled by several council members. And this is the situation right now, we have to, using our best knowledge, the best decision to balance the budget and to run for the future of the city, make sure we don't fail to serve it for the community, and same time we don't fail to maintaining our physical sustainable conditions. That's our duty, that's what we have to do it. Regardless of who was good or the bad council member, we still have to make the decision today for the future.
Mr. Kim, can I ask her a question? I gave my paper.
Please.
Javier Gonzalez, President of the Collectico Finance Commission. First, before I ask the question, let me reiterate what the council member was saying. 2 years ago, I stood here and I warned you about this. And I made so many enemies because I said this was coming. And a lot of people hated me and they thought I was protecting one of you guys. You know what, the council members don't serve, I don't serve the council members, they serve us, they serve me. So I wasn't protecting anybody, I was protecting you. This is what we have now. And I warned you guys 2 years ago, nobody listened. And the community was all up in arms against council members. Where are they now? Yeah. So my question to you is that borrowed money, and I feel for Mr. Finley because he's doing a great job and he inherited this, but that borrowed money, how is it going to be repaid?
May I? Yeah, please.
Eduardo, could you flip forward to the slide that shows the baseline projection for 16-17? One more. I'm sorry, the other way. Could you advance one? Perfect, right there. To answer your question, sir, the baseline budget projection we have here includes a line that says debt service to repay the 15-16 deficit. We can only estimate what that deficit is, and we can only estimate what a repayment plan might be considered by the City Council, but if you choose to repay it over 3 years, $1 million has been included in this projection to facilitate that repayment.
Another question is, we know that on our budget there's over $70 million in loans that the city has done to most of the senior complexes. Could we ask for that money back? I think it's like $70 million, or is there a contract where they don't pay into a certain amount of years? Or
it's interesting that housing development loans are called loans, because often the city's contribution to a project is often the third, fourth, or fifth lender in line. They are, in essence, often truly a grant, but they are recorded as loans. They're often funded by federal or state programs. And so even should those loans be repaid, they would be required to be recycled into new housing programs. It's not generally a source of general fund money that was put into those projects. Usually it was a redevelopment housing set aside or a home or a CDBG program. I don't know the city's loan portfolio. I'm not aware of any in the general fund. I believe they are all federal or state programs.
Thank you, Ms. Mayor. Does any council members have more questions? So there we have two options. Borrow the money, or we have to use the major bond money.
And you're talking about 14-15.
14-15 and plus 15-16, we have a 15-16, we're going to have about $3 million of the deficit again.
And so we don't have a capital option for you to draw bonds for 15-16. What we're talking about is borrowing from another fund, probably your utility funds, which have a cash balance, in order to provide a short-term loan for the general fund.
But then we have to pay $1 million for the every year. So we borrow the money for the 1 year, but we're going to end up to pay $1 million for the next year budget. We're going to short again.
The City Council can evaluate a repayment plan that it would like to put in place.
And so I believe we need to have increase our revenue as much as can. And I asked the city manager about the possible increasing the lease amount of the from the city. City rented it to some place. And also we looking for all the revenue to the city. I believe the Omni National Report, I'd like to put next meeting agenda to who owes the city and they didn't pay. So we need to start collecting the money from them.
Did you say Amera National? Which is the housing loans.
Housing loans.
Mm-hmm.
But after we collect it, we still can use it for the southern portion for the poverty it's impacting.
The Amera National housing loans are funded by federal, state, and redevelopment programs, mm-hmm. and would not be available to fund general fund services.
Yes, but we still can use that to serve the southern area of the community.
I would refer back to your housing staff to tell you how those monies could
okay,
be spent.
Okay, thank you. Mm-hmm. But anyhow, even the grant money, we collect the money, we can spend money for the southern level of the community so we can dedicate our budget to other side. Okay. So Mr. Finley, what happened to the, didn't we get working for the microphone last time?
I had the IT department take a look at it, but I'm going to have them take a look at it again. They apparently said it was fixed, but I'll make sure they take a look at it again.
They might need to pull the new wires.
I think we're going to need to replace the whole microphone.
Yeah. Go ahead, Ms. Hurtado.
Ms. Meyer, I just
need... I think it's the microphone.
Yeah, your voice is stronger than mine. Ms. Meyer, there has been a lot of misrepresentation of what really occurred here, and I think it's really important to point out where we stand, and I know that we don't have closure yet. I know that one day we will, and that day is not soon enough. And this is an important meeting, I think, because we have a lot of our staff here and that are interested in knowing a lot and want to have some better knowledge and information. And I really do appreciate you're always so on point. And I do follow exactly everything that you say, even though, you know, it's so complex. But with regard to the difficult year that we had, which was the 14-15, and the fact that in 14-15, that administration was already within a project of wanting to find this day of smoothing out our finances. If not, they wouldn't have bought the program in 2013. So eventually, all of this was going to come out in the open, because eventually this same staff would have done the work exactly like they're doing it now. But what I want to clarify is that, could you please tell us once again, you said these words. You said in 14-15 we had large unexpected expenses. That to me is, you're trying to tell us that there was things that happened. And I remember because you also said that we still have the risk with our housing program, because our housing program lost the grants. And so what ended up happening there is that was unexpected. And we couldn't do anything about it other than absorb it in our general fund, which was the same thing that you just said now. You said there was executive turnovers, which we all know. We've lost a lot of city managers. And every time that happens, we have to pay them out and all the different amounts that we have to pay them. Then we also had unexpected investigations, which were the result of whistleblowing within our police departments and our different departments. And it is not just the police department investigation. There's a lot of expenses of a lot of things that were trying to be corrected in this city. And the fact that we also have other issues that were unexpected. So I think it's unfair to continuously say that there was misspending. I think that's very inappropriate to say that there was misspending, especially at this point that we don't have the finalization to even know where the unsubstantiated expenses are. So once that is in our hands and we can actually see facts, what was really unsubstantiated here? We'll be able to find that. We'll be able to find it once we know where we went over. And once we know that, what you've already pointed out was something I've always seen that. I've always known that. So I think that I believe that staff here can appreciate that in actuality what we're looking at here is, yes, a very messy year. But just as the auditor was here in November and told us that our city is not going to bankruptcy, it's actually what he said, John. You asked him, what are we between an A and an F? And he said, we're a B. He said, we're manageable. We knew that. But we were going through the progress of wanting to transition. And transitioning, that's why you can't give us anything now. Just like we couldn't receive anything last year either. Because this transition is manual, we talked about that, where it's not you press a button and everything moves over. It is transaction by transaction, physically and manually posting. So this has taken a long time. And it takes a long time to drag all the innuendos, the rhetoric, the suspicions. And I ask this council, if they felt that there was improprieties, it's been 8 months. I would assume that by now somebody would have been called in, the state, some other somebody. But no, we're just dragging this along. So I think it's really important that you clarify that in actuality, when we talk about a deficit here, first of all, you're indicating it's 3, not 6. And you're also indicating that it is due to large unexpected expenses, as you have seen so far. So I think it's really important to clarify that. Because as far as what we're trying to do here in this city is restore the professionalism and the quality of work that we do in our finance department. It's been long overdue. We had that program for 30 years. So I really appreciate that we clarified that. And one day we'll be out of this. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms. Hurtado. Wow, beautiful the language art. To recover certain different ways. Thank you for your language art. I have to learn from your lab. Thank you. I think some council members acknowledged they've been happened wrong. They acknowledged they know, they said that they knew. It's sad. They knew they don't support it.
I believe the Ms. Maya, would you give us the fact the why the one unexpected long amount spent in the 14-15? I think you've been told us last time several times, but I think that we need some people not hearing about that. I need to clarify that, please.
I have no papers in front of me to refresh my memory. There was a PowerPoint that was provided in March that went into detail on this. My recollection is that approximately $3 million was revenues that were overestimated because the Measure H was double counted, and the other side was expenditures that were exceeded the budget. I cannot tell you by department because I simply cannot remember, but I do remember that there was approximately $1 million related to police investigations, but that was not the only issue. There were others as well.
Police investigation about $1 million.
How much was the investigation?
I believe the JPIA insurance increasement about 2 years, about $1.5 million.
Beyond this, I'm going by memory, and I would be doing a disservice to you if I was to quote any more.
Yeah. I have a few things to say. In your expert opinion, because I don't know if this is correct, but I have called other cities, and other cities that have gone from the old MOMS system to the Springbrook system, they have always been able to give their council information or quarterly reports because they run a parallel system with the MOMS system until it's consolidated. That's the way it should be done, correct? And where I'm going with this is because saying that they bought the system in 2013 and saying that, you know, they wanted to do the right thing is one thing, but actually not running parallel systems or I mean, you have a ledger anyway, so you can still give numbers, correct? Manual ledger. So, you know, it takes 3 years to implement from MOMS to Springbrook because other cities have done it in months.
There are many reasons why financial system implementations succeed or fail. I would say the primary reasons that it failed at this city and took as long as it did were lack of resources and lack of planning. And finally, the other reason is that, in my opinion, the entire implementation was done backwards. The chart of accounts was the last thing that was done instead of the first thing.
So it was done backwards.
Yes, there were third-party softwares that needed customized interface. You have a different company that does your utility billing and your business license. There was no interface that was designed. Staff was not trained. The biggest issue was lack of planning and lack of resources. If you're going to install a new system within a few months, which certainly can be done, there needs to be a strong focus and drive to get it done. The reason reports were not able to be prepared in this situation was that you had your receipts coming into your old system and you had your payments going out of the other. You had financial transactions in two different systems. You had many financial transactions that weren't recorded in either system. There were millions of dollars of unrecorded transactions.
Millions of dollars of unrecorded transactions.
And goodness, this is what took months to put back together.
Wow. The $3 million you're saying we're in the red is taking pretty much all of Measure H funds.
Yes.
Okay. If we don't use Measure H funds, we're going to be closer to four?
Measure H provides $2.7 million a year, of which $1 million is dedicated to a bond payment. So you end up with about $1.7 million of discretionary.
So it would be about $4.7 million in the red.
And of that, you have historically.
July 1st, if we don't take from Measure H. Correct.
So we're talking about, I'm sorry, are you talking about 16-17?
Yeah, 16-17.
16-17, yes. There's 1.7 million.
So we'd be about 4.7. Okay, now.
Sorry, you're crossing fiscal years.
If no, 15-16. I'm talking 15-16. Correct.
In 15-16, the city has historically spent money for about 1.2 million, 1250 to be precise, for fire and police salaries. In addition, there has been authorization to charge a lease for one of the fire equipment trucks, apparatus, for another $200,000. That last lease payment is in 15-16. And so if we're looking at the discretionary Measure H money in 15-16, it's a different number than 16-17. In 16-17, you're looking at 1.7. And again, all this is predicated on a sales tax estimate. Mm-hmm. Your sales tax consultant will be here next week and may give us new numbers. We hope they are positive, and we will stay tuned to see what they tell us is available.
So it's $3 million for sure, and it could go higher, correct?
If the measure best available estimate.
Yeah. Now, as far as 14-15, at one point we were at an overspending of $6 million. That, my understanding is that has gone down to $5 million? Is that...
No. If the City Council adopts the resolution tonight to draw bond proceeds of $678,000 to reimburse itself for capital expenditures in 13-14 and 14-15, mm-hmm. the general fund will be balanced for 14-15.
But they did overspend the $4.5 million in reserves.
No, the revenues, the gap between revenues and expenditures was $6
million. $6 million, yes. Okay, all right. So there was $6 million overspent, pretty much. In layman's terms, okay. Okay.
Okay.
$6 million, 14-15. Yes.
Expenditures over revenue.
Yes.
Yeah, it's just expenditure over revenue, $6 million, plus the...
Yeah, I think we
have we have an enterprise fund, $6.2 million. Spend it, and other the grant we might spend $1.5 million. Spend it, so there was not budget. Causing $13.5 million, we spend it 14-15, overspend it. And I'm sad because our council member they knew it. I wish they said I didn't know, but they knew it. So they knew it, that means they knew it. They we overspending $13.5 million. Spend it. I'm sad for that.
Can I make a comment?
Please.
Because we got to move on. I mean, this is definitely not, it's going to take, we'll be here all night, but I just want to say that I don't think anybody, including the people here, including the council, I hope maliciously, including people that were on the finance committee at that time, I think Mr. Ben Horton, Yoli Cordero, Mrs. Gomez, and I used to go to your meetings, and you know I don't think anybody maliciously wanted to cause any harm to the city. I think that everybody here wants the city to be the best city in the county, if not in the state. But you know, I have to take responsibility for. The actions that I took, which is to go ahead and support the past administration, and you know it just so happened to be that there was in my situation we had fake documents that showed that the budget was balanced. We had a lot of people, you know, many of you here promoting those administrators. And you know it's mistakes that we do, and they're unfortunate, but the taxpayer is the one, and the people here and are the people that get hurt. But I go back and I just remember the emotion, Maribel. You remember that emotion, right? The emotion that people, you know, were coming up here screaming, screaming at me, and you know, give him his contract. If you don't give him his contract, you know, this and that, and we're gonna recall you, and so, you know, it was pressure. It was pressure, and so I just hope that in the future, you know, we're all the people here that were promoting him. I mean, or promoting that administration. You know, they're no longer here. Very few, but you know, I just hope that we next time around we think things through a little more and make sure that we don't just jump to conclusions to think that somebody is the Messiah that's going to come in and just save everybody, and that we ask, for example, when I was getting ready to vote on a contract, you know, I wanted numbers. I was asking for numbers, and I remember asking certain people, certain colleagues of mine, hey, you know, how can we give this person a contract when they haven't even given us numbers? Don't worry about it. They're professionals. Everything's going to be okay. Seriously, I was told that. you know, and I'm being new to the council, and you know, I was like, well, okay, fine, maybe it's right, maybe they are professionals, we'll be okay. And so, you know, I just hope that I just want to tell the council and the people here that next time, you know, let's not let our emotions get the best of us. Let's make good decisions based on critical thinking, and hopefully we make the right choice. And again, I guess all I can say is I'm sorry for making that wrong choice. And I guess man enough to admit that I messed up. So
thank you, Mr. Hill.
Mr. Kim, I just have one thing to say.
Yes.
And I've been listening to this rhetoric for a while now, but if we look at, and thank you for that presentation, Ms. Myers, very informative. If we look at the 13-14.
What about mine?
I'm sorry?
What about my presentation?
If we look at the 13-14, I'm to assume that there was a balanced budget on that year. I'm looking at slide number 16-17. Page 3. It's not on there. But there seems to be a balanced budget at that time.
No.
No?
No, we have about $4 million.
No, 13-14.
Yeah, even
13-14. 13-14, we have...
Okay, so at 13-14 fiscal year, I believe we had one city manager that was fired by Mr. Kim, Mr. Castro, Mr. Hodge, who brought in Mr. Warren.
They brought in Takata.
Okay, Takata, well, that, yeah, a couple of months. But I didn't vote for Mr. Warren. I voted to keep Mr. Rodriguez. It seemed that he had the financial wherewithal to balance the budget. And I didn't agree with the way things happened. So I accept blame like everybody else up here should, that we let this go on as long as it did. But Mr. Kim continually says that there were other council members who didn't care or were apathetic or whatever he said, but that weren't really were supporting the administration. Well, I didn't support the administration from the get-go. He did, and he does not say he did, but he did, along with Castro and Hodge. So if we're going to set the record straight, Mr. Kim, let's set the record straight. It was you and Hodge and Castro that brought in Takata, then they brought in Warren. Okay, and so we had to work with those administrators. We have no choice. We were outvoted. But I just want to set the record straight that that's what happened. And then eventually, well, we run into some deficits that I see. And hopefully, we can continue working as a team and be transparent, listen to our advisors, and see how we can work this out. Because what I see in the audience today is about 90% of them employees that give up their service or give their service so that this city runs efficiently. And I believe we owe them that courtesy. So without any further ado, I think we can move on to the next item now that I've corrected the record.
Okay, so you're correct. You're correct, me and Castro, and at that time, Hodge, Mr. Hodge was to remove the, not to remove it, to be accepting the Mr. Rodriguez to resign. And that year, it's been almost $4 million negative. And our team brought other money to cover for that negative, so make the balance it. But actually, they were overspending almost $4 million 13-14. Yes, it's not, they did good, because they are the ones starting to all the bad budget starting, so that they were balanced it the way they already had almost $4 million in negative.
Manny, can and you have translate?
They have,
let him finish.
This is how I did to this guy. That he's an educator. I worry about our kids educating by under his education. Okay. They were hiding the number. They were bring the wrong number since that administration. I single meeting questioned their incorrect numbers. They are
They are fighting with us. I've been fighting for since then. They removed the report. They tried to remove me from the chamber. Yes, I vote for the Takada. Yes, I would vote for the Mr. Wong coming in. But since I know it's not working, so we tried to remove him. But who support him? Mr. Hodge, Mr. Moreno, Stone Guard to put it in front of the Mr. Luan, the Mr. Hurtado together. Mr. Castro.
Maybe Mr. Castro wants to speak.
She wants to talk. Go ahead.
Everybody here, the majority of the council, and I would like to remind everyone, City of Calexico, financially, we was wrong since 2008. Yes, I do support the resign of Mr. Carrillo. Why? Well, first of all, Mr. Carrillo, Mr. Oscar Rodriguez, and why? Because back then, since 2010, the expenditures, the percentage of the expenditures was more than the revenues since back then with Mr. Carrillo, and also with Mr. Rodriguez, I exposed the same issue. And that's one of the reasons they took my position as a mayor. That's something I do not care. I'm just mentioning because I exposed the truth on the city webpage. That's the reason I support to resign for those city councils, city managers. So this is not something new. I've been here for almost 8 years, and I've been exposing. Yes, I do support Mr. Takara. I do. Back then, also the other city manager, who was that? Mr. Warren. But guess what? If you check the records, I didn't support the finance with Mr. John Quinn. I didn't support the records that Mr. Richard Warren gave us because they lied to us. We are not an accounting persons. Well, I'm talking about myself, but we are here to work for the benefit or the good policy for the citizen of Calexico. That's the reason we are here. But I noticed that since 2010, and now today, Mrs. Mayor. I'm sorry, I didn't pronounce your last name. But Mrs. Meyer, she gave us the numbers today. And I'm very glad that the majority of the staff of the city of Calexico are here and listening about the numbers. But back then, what is done is done. But today, now, we as a city council, we need to work with administration and prioritize the services of Calexico. There's no other options. There is no other option. Either city staff and council work with administration or not. There's no other options. So that's good. Again, that's good that the staff concerned are here today. This is like a private business. If we are going to continue to the expenditures more than the revenues, we are not going to make it. In the worst part, this is serious. If we, the council, like today we have the warrants, the expenditures here, if we continue to support those expenditures, you know what? We are wrong. And probably we continue like that, we can go to jail, believe it or not. I mean, why? Because the majority of the council support that to the city manager, So the city manager, he's got a very, responsibility decision. That's all I can say. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Castro. Ms. Mario, thank you very much for the presentation. I believe since I was involving with the government budget since 2009, early 9, I think like the first time I seen the real budget number. School district, all the fake number coming out. One time I proved it in front of everybody. They called me yellow. And the city of Calexico, since I was steps in, they all the fake number I've been questioning. And right now, we finally see the right number. I'm sad we are negative, but we still see the right number. Thank you, Ms. Mayor. Ms. Mayor. So we go to next.
I'm sorry, Kim. Yes. I'm sorry to interrupt you, but just to would you please open the city web page and look for the mayor message, Mr. Castro, mayor message, and you're going to find the truth since back then. Thank you.
Same reason I didn't put my message, because I don't want to make the community look bad.
Mr. Mayor, before we move on, I believe staff needs council direction to move forward to develop a workout plan and a financing plan in order to bring the general plan in balance for the 15-16 year. That's what staff is requesting. Yeah, we need to move forward because we've got very little time.
Okay,
that's great, but I would like to hear the recommendation from the city manager on that issue, because it's very important where we are going to get that money from.
How we going to be?
I would like to hear one or two or three options.
Well basically, we in order to work out this financial workout plan, we need to move forward because we have a deadline of June 30th. So the funding that we have available will either be from our wastewater treatment, our wastewater fund, our water fund, or one of those enterprise funds that has the money available. And so we're on a short timeline that we have to do this before June 30th. So what we're asking is for you to allow us to go ahead and find out which funding we can use to borrow or lease the money from and get this lease to lease this workout plan and make that decision, because we are in a short timeline. So,
but we cannot keep borrowing the money neither. We need to increase our revenue, and at the same time, we're going to try to cut our expenditure too.
Basically, we're on a short timeline. We're going to have to repay this money, whether it's in a three-year plan or a four-year plan, where it's either $1 million per year or $750,000 per year, and then maybe try to build some reserve funds. We need to sit down and with finance and Ms. Myers and make this determination, because we have 45 days.
Okay, I think Mr. Castro was mentioning was the right correct things. So we have to have up 2-3 options to bring all the resources we can use it to bring the. Can you bring the next council meeting?
It has to be today. No.
Not
it has
today.
To be today.
No.
Well.
No, we're just giving the directions.
We just need direction at this.
Ah, okay.
Point.
To can you bring the next council meeting?
Yes, we can.
Please. Okay, number 11.
There again, we'd appreciate a motion to that effect.
A motion?
Yeah, to come through. Back at the next council meeting with a proposed
okay.
workout.
Second
plan.
So I make the motion to bring the all the possible options, 2-3 options, to the next council meeting.
Aye.
Aye.
Aye. Mr. Real?
Aye.
Mr. Real, aye. Ms. Hurtado? She stepped out. She said that she's waving the hands.
What?
Okay, number, she's waving the hands. She doesn't want to be a vote. Okay, so we go pass by 4-2.
One absent.
One absence. Absent by Mr. Hurtado. Okay, we have number 11. We're going to have some people talking about that, so we're going to read the agenda first. Allocation of $678,750 from the 2014 major H sales tax lease revenue bonds to the city's general fund to balance the fiscal year 2014-2015. We have public, general public wants to talk. This person's talk wants to talk about here, 1, 2, 3 persons. Okay, we want to talk to Javier Gonzalez.
Again, Honorable Mayor, Council members, members of the public, Javier Gonzalez, President of the Calexico Finance Commission. This issue is very difficult, and I want to give thanks to our city manager, interim city manager. He's done a great job. He inherited this problem, but one of the things that worries us, especially me, that I never supported Measure H. I knew this was going to happen. You guys are borrowing from Measure H, and not one project has been done of what the people voted or expected. Yes, I know money has been given to the police and the fire department, which is great, but you know what? We already have talked in the community of repealing Measure H and actually putting it back into the ballot with specific spending things. There's already a movement out there, recalling the money, because I don't have money. I'm not gonna be paying extra money when I don't see it spending in what it was meant to be. Like I said, I support the interim city manager. He's between a hard rock and a hard place. He's done a great job. Is there some other way we can raise revenue and everything, but from Measure H? I don't know if enterprise funds, you guys can borrow from enterprise, you can't. Well, I just like to say that I never supported Measure H, and it would be great if this matters would be dealt by the Measure H committee, which they probably haven't met in months. But again, I'm not supportive of getting the money from Measure H, but still, my hat's off to the city manager. He's done a great job, and it is something he inherited, and he's doing a great job. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Gonzalez. Next person, Mr. Yanez, Manuel Yanez.
Good evening, council members. Good evening, citizens of Calexico. Mrs. Mayor, you did a nice presentation, a really good presentation. But citizens of Calexico, they vote for the Measure H. I think we have to remind the mission of Measure H. The Measure H was funds were to create a fire station, to build a swimming pool, and for park improvements. That was the mission and the mission urge. What happened? We have forgot the mission. We are seeing those funds as a resource for the general fund right now. I knew that will happen in the past. I had talked about it many, many times here. I don't know, 4 or 5 times. The committee, the Measure H committee, on April 18, 2016, they discussed about these Measure H funds. And they were discussed the request to use those funds. And they recommend the city staff to find an alternative way to balance the general fund. The committee took a vote, and they voted 3-0. No one of them were approving to use those funds. What is the reason to have a committee if we are not going to listen to the committee? You have a big responsibility to city councils. Don't forget the mission of the Measure H funds. I had a question to myself, and it's just to myself only. Is the administration, the current administration, not doing the work to balance the general fund? Or the current administration does not know how to balance the general fund. I'm going to believe this is the first thing. It's not doing the proper work to do the general fund, to balance the general fund. If they're not doing it, then they have to have someone to do it right. Someone that knows how to do the general fund balance. I want to believe that they know how to do it, and they would like to do it. I want to believe that. But the measure is funds, and I believe the city of Calexico reserve a real respect for the city council members right now that they have to vote to use those funds. If the general funds are used to other purposes that they originally made, then the city of Calexico won't believe on the present city council members. You will be lying to the city council members. You as city council members will be lying and the misuse of these funds. Appropriate use has to be done. It's a big decision. You use those funds right now, you use $700,000 right now, you're gonna do it next time. And you're gonna do it next time, and next year, and next year. I have talked here so many times. I have more than a year coming here to this forum. And I'm listening to the same thing. The general fund is not balanced, and we are doing something wrong. We have to do another option. It's a poor city, and we have to know that. We don't have the funds, we have to use another option. We don't have to use the parks improvements.
Thank you, Mr. Kim.
Thank you.
Next person is Lorena Minor.
I'm sorry, I only have four copies. John, you were late. I didn't make a copy for you. You could share. Lorena Minod, president of CMEA for the employees here at City of Calexico. Sometimes the council forgets to do their homework, and today I did some homework for you guys. A couple of weeks ago, I did homework for you guys. Apparently, you guys didn't know that Adrian Cordova had a CFD, and I paid CFDs for over 5 years, and I reminded you guys. Today, I did homework on Measure H. This is the ordinance that was approved on June 8, 2010. On the first page it says, and this is how it read on the ballot, shall the ordinance to prevent further cuts and preserve funding for the general city services, including fire protection and paramedics, police protection and crime prevention, street repair and maintenance, and avoiding closure of recreation, my people, programs, parks, and libraries by enacting a half-cent sales tax and a general tax for 20 years be adopted. Now, can you turn to page number 6, Mr. Real, and read number 17 for everybody, please?
This is your comment, actually.
I'm sorry?
This is your comment. I'm not supposed to...
No, it's not my comment, but this is an ordinance.
You can read it.
Okay, I'll read it then. So read it or look at it while I read it. Number 17 says... Thank you, Ms. Hurtado.
If the tax is approved by the voters, the proceeds of the tax shall be deposited into the general fund to provide for general governmental services.
Thank you. Thank you for your presentation, Ms. Myers. This is the proof that general fund measure aids can go to general fund. I don't approve or deny or whatever you guys decide to do today. This legalizes what Ms. Meyer is recommending today. What council members David Uzan, John Moreno, Mr. Castro, Mr. Hermosillo passed, and the only no was Mr. Romero. And it was passed back in June of 2010. And this affects myself as an employee and myself as a resident of the city of Calexico. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Menor. Ms. Menor, the next person, Mr. Pete Mercado.
Why do we have a measure? Good evening, staff. Pete Mercado from the City of Calexico Fire Department. You guys will be faced with a really difficult challenge here in how to fix this issue of a gap. Okay, $670-some thousand is not just a payroll check or something coming out of the city, so it's a significant amount of money. One of the problems that you have to consider is that this money is taken from a bond measure, okay, the bond measure and the proceeds for Measure H. And for those that weren't fully aware of what this bond measure was supposed to do was, we went out to bond to do three specific projects. One was to improve parks, one was to contribute to the pool, but the majority of that money was to build a fire station. And this project has been kind of in the minds of everyone for the past,
4 years?
5 years maybe. And every year, that amount of money starts to decrease. Started at 7.5. I saw some figures come in where there was expenditures made against that, which, you know, I questioned and I have not received a response to. So that concerns me. The expenses that were used under that Measure H bond money was a time and travel study to figure out where would be the best location for a new fire station, what would service our community best, and we went and did that. We also decided what would be our best suitable facility, not for what we need now, but what we need for the next 20 or 30 years, because we don't build fire stations every 5 years. So when you look at the money now to borrow from that $7.5 million that was initially allocated for our fire facility, that won't even probably furnish half of our facility. So the problem is that there really is no set solution. And to say that Measure H has been misused, well, I have to correct Mr. Yannis on here, is that that we used Measure H, $1 million use of Measure H for police and fire because there was that shortage. And it was $1 million every year. So it's $1.2 million now. That's been in there. That's nothing new. So I don't have a solution for you. I mean, you're going to have to decide where you want to get that money from. But I will remind you that our firefighters here at Downtown Station are living and working in deplorable conditions. They will not pass a health and safety inspection. They will let alone not pass a fire inspection. We cannot take a shower without having water drip on the downstairs dining table. My secretary has to go use the restroom at her house or next door at the PD. So I'm not here to say don't give the money and balance our budget, because that may mean that we don't have the opportunity to service the city anymore. That's the realities of it. So it's not so much to lend blame to past city managers, which we have a half a dozen to choose from, but the idea is that we have to figure out what the solution is. And the solution is that we'd love to put more grass in our parks. We'd love to build a facility of baseball parks, because believe me, that's my full-time job outside of this, is contributing to the youth of our community. But the point is that we need to definitely look at how we're providing those services. The fire department spending over the past 5 years had been reactive spending. Something breaks, we fix it. The first expense out of Measure H, for those that don't know, were the fire engines. And we leased those for 5 years because we were working with equipment that was 20 years old and insufficient to deliver the services that we were delivering to our city. We were spending more in maintenance and operations than we were in the cost of the lease. 5 year lease, that's why the lease is done at the end of this year, right, Ms. Myers? So, and that's done. So that will free up an additional $465,000 approximately for future expenses. So not everyone is to really blame for all this, but you need to really look at ensuring the facilities for our department so that our firefighters and anyone else that works out of the emergency services there has a respectable place to live and work, that we are able to afford the same facilities that any other facility has. We shouldn't settle for anything less. So I really don't have a solution for you on how you're going to be doing that, but that money was bonded for our facility. And I urge the council that they really sit down and expedite this, probably a second order of business after you balance this budget, is that you sit down and figure out where we're going with our plan to build our new fire facility. That has to be a top priority because we cannot operate out of one station on the west side when this one's closed down. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Mercado. For the Finley, I believe we bought a trailer. The firemen to stay in condition is improved, isn't it?
We are currently working the I just signed some requisitions for the fire department today to continue making the changes needed to the old courthouse to move them over as soon as possible. So we're expediting that for them because the facilities are just getting worse. And I've been working closely with the fire chief, and I just, as a matter of fact, signed some additional requisitions today to make some improvements that are necessary in order to move the facility temporarily over to the courthouse. The courthouse isn't really suitable for their operation. It's just a temporary location due to the fact of the conditions that the current facility finds itself. It is unoccupable at this point, and I'd like to... The firemen that are here, I thank them for doing what they've done and not really complaining any more than they should have because that place is not suitable for occupancy.
But the trailer we bought it, we can give them the decent level of condition of the living there.
I mean, correct. Temporarily, that's temporary. What we're doing. Correct.
So it's no longer issues on the showers, no longer issues on the staying.
We are currently working on getting them the kitchen, the dormitories, and the some of the administration improvements that they need in order for them to be able to move over there.
Okay. Do we clean all the mold? The mold.
We can't do anything about the mold until they move out of that facility.
Okay. Thank you.
Can I ask?
Sure, please.
Yes, Silvia Bernard, can you please tell us how many KG machines that the Heffernan Memorial Hospital Board are donated to the fire department? How many machines?
EKG machines.
EKG machines. Four?
You bought four and six are sitting there?
Oh, no, four. We gave them. I'm
sorry.
Four. Oh, different blades.
Okay. Thank you.
Thank you. But there's full service, full moving. Full in service, the four, the EKG. So there's full moving around. There's still full operational. EKG machine.
There are four new EKG machines that they're brand new, state of the art, that will be replacing four existing non-compliant ones any longer that they will be replacing.
Now on the street, is not yet?
No, they're on order. They haven't gotten here yet. They're on order.
They're coming. Oh, thank you. Okay, and I believe the help of the college was another question. What I understand, this one is the council approved that for the major H, the bond, I mean the major H sales tax, but end of the when they put the actual violet, is not the same as the city ordinance. I understand what I'm understanding. The last moment they adding the as a general fund.
I don't recall, Mr. Kim. I haven't seen the document. I don't remember exactly what was on the ballot.
Yeah. So would you bring the copy of the real ballot, the major sales tax ballot?
The wording on
the that way we all the kill the some different issues. They one side they saying that approved the voters approved as a. General budget too. That's why, based on that, that's why former administration, they put the sales, major H sales tax as a general fund because they were approved as a general fund too.
We'll research that and bring that back
yes,
to you.
Yes, please. Okay, so now we hear from the people. Let's say with the council members. Do we have any comment on the number 11 or question? Mr. Hurtado? Mr. Moreno?
No.
Mr. Leal?
No.
Mr. Castro?
I think we, that's the way I think, we can borrow the money from either water department or sewer department, and then we can, the city can work, and how can we pay the money in 3 years with interest, and that's, believe that's one of the solutions. That's the way I think.
So
that is my personal.
You wanna deny or you wanna table it?
What I understand, we can either support today or we can continue with this item. Is that something that we need to vote today, Mr. Mayor, Mr. Hargrave?
At this point, this is really the council's only option for balancing the 14-15
okay.
budget. I mean, if you don't do this, then we still have an unbalanced 14-15 budget, which is a serious problem going forward in terms of a workout plan. This will be the
okay.
really the first step to a
practical. Has Measure H approved it already? The board of Measure H?
No. They denied it.
They denied it?
Yeah.
Right. So, well, that is my recommendation, and we need to look for a solution today. That's what I understand.
I think that it's unfortunate that the voters were sold this Measure H for something completely different than what it is. It was written for a general fund, and it was sold for public safety and parks, and it's unfortunate. But it's if we take that money and just throw it in our general fund and circumvent the Measure H, then as council members, we're saying, listen, we're kind of adopting, hey, they lied to you, and we're going to continue to lie to you because it's supposed to be for one thing, and we're using it for whatever we want. I think the council needs to either get rid of Measure H and just say, listen, this is general fund, we lied to you, oh well, or make sure that we listen to our Measure H board, because they're the ones that have to give us permission to use that money.
Well, there's two bonds. One is a general obligation, and the other is a special tax. The special tax required 3/4 vote of the public, and that would only then would have been used as it was promoted. This is general obligation, which is 50% plus one vote, and that's why. We're using it as a general fund. The other way, it wouldn't have passed if we would have required 3/4 vote, 75%. So this is like going to the dentist. We're damned if we do, and we're damned if we don't. So either way, we have to balance that budget, but we don't want to use Measure H, but we don't have any other choice.
Also, it's my understanding that the financial team has gone back and looked at expenditures over the years and found that the money that's represented here actually qualifies for the Measure H bond money. Is that correct? I mean, these are capital expenditures that were made that were consistent with the Measure H bond. So it's not like, the money's being misallocated. It's money that was spent on stuff that is properly spent on Measure H bonds, and we need to get this authorization so we can kind of basically repay the general fund for money that was spent on stuff that qualifies under the bond.
Does this, Mr. City Manager, if we approve this, would there be an opportunity to pay it back?
Yes, they will. We would just have to find the funding and the resources in order to replenish and repay that money back.
Over 3 to 5 years or something like that?
Yeah. Are there any legal... Yeah. ramifications of doing this without going through Measure H? We can jump Measure H, no big deal.
This one is the
Measure H
bond.
Why do we have them then?
Mr. Leal, this is only the Measure H bond, not the Measure H sales tax. This one,
I understand, but that
this
bond,
money
okay.
with using the sales tax, they use the bond as a general fund to do several projects. So at that time, I was against it, issuing the general bond, I mean the major bond, because once they issuing the bond, now they become a general fund. The city council, anytime they can change the object of the usage, any general fund, they can use it like almost like a general fund. That's why I was against it, issue the bond, because that's out of the major boundaries. Go ahead.
Yes, I have a question. Mr. Hargrave, we legally, as a city, we can borrow the money from Measure H? Legally?
Yes.
Actually, if you do what's proposed, you're not borrowing the money. You're just allocating Measure H bond funds to capital projects that have already been paid for by the general fund. And you, based on my understanding of staff's recommendation, yes, you can legally do this. This is not a problem.
Thank you.
Thank you.
It's kind of like a reimbursement.
Yeah, please.
Go ahead, please.
I hear genuine concern by your stakeholders and from the council about this proposal. I do recommend that you take actions to balance your 14-15 budget so that you stay in compliance with the government code and you do not go into debt. However, recognizing how sensitive a program this is, you can also direct staff to replenish the money in 15-16 or in 16-17 to restore the money for your fire station or your other projects. I do recommend that you take this action to balance 14-15, but clearly it is within your policy option to direct staff to use Measure H money to restore the bond funds for the intended programs.
Thank you, Ms. Meyer.
I move that we take staff recommendations and replenish the supply within, I guess, 16-17.
Well, Mr. Moreno's motion to approve it. And
second.
We have second by Mr. Real. Do we have any comment?
Well, what's the motion?
Yeah, let's do it.
Motion to approve it.
To approve it. Okay.
To clarify, Ms. Hurtado, is to approve the $678,750 from the 14 Measure H tax lease revenue bonds to balance the 14-15 budget and then repay back in 2 years from future revenues. No, from future general fund revenues. Is that the recommendation? Yeah.
Mayor, may I?
Yes, go ahead, please.
Yeah, I'm supporting that, Mr. Moreno, but I will recommend 3 years with
the 3-year timeline.
Also with interest every year. That's my recommendation.
But this one doesn't have to pay the interest.
No.
Yeah, because
are you sure?
It's not the enterprise fund. So we don't have to borrow the money. Mm-hmm. We don't have to pay interest. But we among ourselves to. We have a responsibility to the community. If we want to refund the money in 3 years, we don't have to pay the interest just for
okay.
the money.
So
in
even
3 years.
Better.
Yes.
Okay.
So we'll go. I'll rescind the 2-year stipulation and go 3. So it's $226,000 a year that we need to repay for the 3 years.
Okay. Mr. Moreno made the motion to borrowing the
second.
Money.
Second.
And then pay back in 3 years.
Second.
Second by Mr. Leal.
Aye.
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 We passed by 5-0 unanimous. And number 12.
That's 14-15.
Number 12. Set public hearing date to ratify Planning Commission's approval of amendment of the Sheridan Street between
Motion to approve.
Herold Avenue and Oldie Avenue.
Motion to approve.
Second.
Aye.
Motion made by, yes, I think we need to have a little explanation from the city staff.
Basically, it's recommended that the council set a public hearing for the ratification of the Planning Commission's approval to abandon the street, Sherman Street between Herold and Ollie Avenue. We are currently going to be demoing the armory. So what we're looking to do is abandon that street and include the armory property and Heber Park as one whole park area, get rid of the street in between there, and utilize the whole area as a park area and do some improvements on this property.
Thank you, Mr. Finley. I have a question. This one is the fiscal impact by RDA bond money, not the general fund? General fund?
That's correct.
Thank you. So we have a motion by Mr. Real?
Yes.
Second by Mr. Moreno to approve it?
Aye.
We have some any discussion?
No.
I'd like to just make a comment. I'm a little note today because the staff report indicates a little different story than I've seen from my commissioner. So just because of that, I'm not able to approve this today.
Okay. Okay, so we're gonna vote for the Mr. Real. Mr. Real?
Yeah.
The vote?
Aye.
Aye. Mr. Castro? Aye. Mr. Moreno?
Aye.
Ms. Hurtado said no? On but the condition of the... On the
we're just vote? Setting a public hearing.
Correct.
Yeah, public hearing.
Okay. Okay. All right.
And I said no, yes. Mm-hmm. We have passed 4-1. No, no, Ms. Hurtado. And number 13, and consideration of the following of the ordinance. Ordinance number 1170, an urgency ordinance of the City Council of the City of Calexico, California, enacted pursuant to California Government Code Section 36937, adding Chapter 5.98 to the City of Calexico Municipal Code, prohibiting off-site display and the sale of automobiles in the city. The B, ordinance number 1171, an ordinance of the City Council of the City of Calexico, California, adding Chapter 5.98 to the City of Calexico Municipal Code, prohibiting off-site display and the sale of automobile in the city. Mr. Hargrave, do we have to approve the one by one, A and B separately, or have to, can we approve both?
I would suggest that you take them separately because A is an urgency ordinance and it needs to pass with 4/5 votes, and B is just a regular ordinance which would pass with 3/5 votes. And just in terms of an explanation, several months ago you adopted a moratorium on tent sales. That moratorium was for 45 days, and then the council didn't act to extend that moratorium, so at this point, we can't really adopt another moratorium, but we can adopt an urgency ordinance which will be effective immediately, which mm-hmm. is the A, which requires a 4/5 vote. And then we kind of back it up with just a regular ordinance which would become effective in essentially 60 days.
Okay, thank you. Okay, we have a public comment. Maribel Padilla.
Maribel Padilla, Calexico. I've been here before on this subject, and I'm against it. You guys did a moratorium, so you guys could have a study on how it affected the local car dealers. I don't see the study in the backup. I looked for it. So where's the study? If you're going to study how this works, you're going to go see, talking about Direct Auto Plaza when they had their sale 3 to 4 days, 2-3 months ago, how many cars they sold, how much money came in taxes to the budget, I mean to the city. Then you're going to go and see what all the other car dealerships here are bringing in monthly. You study these things. You haven't studied anything. You're not showing the citizens anything. Why are we banning people from coming here that are giving us taxes for this city that's so hurt? You're financially, you're having to borrow from Measure H, but oh no, let's not have people come in from another city and try to give us tax money. How does that make sense to any of you? I'm gonna say this again, Mr. Moreno, you should never have brought this item up because you have the biggest conflict of interest ever. You're just alongside Mr. Castro. Yes, you are, Mr. Moreno. Your brother-in-law owns Robinson Ford, okay? That is a conflict of interest. Just like Mr. Castro voted against the transit issues when he owns the transit. Oh, I'm sorry, his son owns the transit. Your brother-in-law owns Robinson Ford, or the three of them, or whoever it is. It is a conflict of interest. Yes, it is. I don't know.
A conflict of interest is an immediate family member, a brother, a wife, a spouse, or a son, or a daughter. That's a conflict of interest, Ms. Padilla, for no, your...
It's
for
still in the family. Please. Your sister's married to one of the owners. So it's a conflict of interest. I don't care how you guys put it. Why don't we try to get Direct Auto Plaza and Rogers & Rogers to come here and actually put up a setup permanently? Why don't we? Even if you try, though, they're not going to want to because they've seen you people and how you act. They've seen how Calexico is so screwed up. They don't want to come here. But yet they're doing tent sales. I can bet you the 40 cars, because I was there. I went to the tent sale. I asked questions. They had sold 40 cars, used cars. Not one single Ford was sold, used cars. And you're going to tell me that Robinson Ford can sell 40 cars in a month? I doubt it. I doubt very much Robinson Ford is selling 40 cars a month. These guys did it, even though it's used, in 3 to 4 days and brought in revenue. It does not make sense for you to stop people coming into the city to bring us revenue and taxes. Yeah, I'm sure you want me to shut up. Yeah. It doesn't make sense. You cannot vote on this.
Thank you, Ms. Padilla. Mr. Time is off.
Do something for our city and let's get this revenue in instead of stopping it.
Thank you, Padilla. Okay, the next person is the Lorena Minor.
Lorena Minor, president of CMEA. I had a personal invitation today to come by Councilman Member Real. He told me that I should be very angry as an employee and that I should come to the meeting regarding the tent sales because it's losing money to the membership. I saw his Facebook and it said that there was talk of layoffs and that we would be losing money to the city budget. Well, I'm gonna off track a little bit, and I'm gonna talk about revenue. You guys were talking about revenue, how to bring revenue. I'm gonna give you an idea. Building permits were reduced, along with other, with business licenses, impact fees, fire inspections, planning fees, and engineering fees on December 1st, 2015. These were approved by Mr. Castro, Mr. Real, and Mr. Moreno. Ms. Hurtado recused herself, and Mr. Kim abstained. I have the agenda right here. So I gave you guys a graph of solar panels. And it's not on here. On 2013, 35 solar panels were issued at $500 each. It made $17,500. That's not on here. At our price now, $98, it brings $3,070. At 2016, $500, it would have brought $250,000. At the price you guys brought it down, which is $98, it brings $49,000. We have in our office more than 500 solar panels permits that we have issued. That's the only permit
with plans that are reviewed by at least 6 staff members: receptionist, plan checker, building manager, building inspector, permit technician, etc. There's no plan check fee for that permit. Other permits like patios, room additions, there's a $100 now plan check fee. It used to be $445 when prior to December 1st. So we lost revenue of $211,000 alone with solar panels, just with solar panels. Now, we can go on with other permits, but I'm not going to do that. I'm going to go on to more revenue. On last meeting, I believe, on May 3rd, Mr. Real wanted to indefinitely remove the meters downtown. Now, the ordinance was changed, and Mr. Real and Mr. Castro, where am I? Well, unanimously, you guys all decided to temporarily remove them. This brings in approximately annually $600,000 on quarters to the general fund. Now, you guys, this is not even counting citations. I understand you guys want to help downtown, but I see personally, like Maribel said, have you guys done your homework? How many people actually pay a quarter to stay downtown? I see a lot of people paying a quarter to leave their car and go to Mexicali. Most of the people come and get a month permit, one of the month's permit, the monthly or whatever they call it, and pay $20 to park in the city parking lot. That's what I see more frequently. I don't know how many people pay the monthly permit, but we get more people coming to pay the $20 monthly permit. So those are two ideas that I can give to you to raise money, revenue, because the ordinance that was done on December 1st is a temporary. You guys have hit the general fund with fees and don't realize it. You guys, Councilmember Hurtado keeps talking about business licenses, but you guys keep forgetting about developer fees for building permits, for planning permits. And how many people, how many staff members touch these? The other day we went to order supplies, folders. No, you can't ask me anything. Didn't you say that earlier? These are my minutes.
And you've gone over.
And I've gone over, but minutes, I'm just going to say the other day we went to go.
But you went up
the other day we went to go order folders, and they say we couldn't order folders because the city has no money.
Are you for or against the tent sales? That's
okay. Thank you.
I'm for the tent sales because it brings in revenue to the city.
Okay.
Thank you, Mr. Vinor. We gave you too much time already. So 5 minutes. Thank you.
I have some questions for staff. Ralph, could you come up here, please?
Wait, please. No, we don't have any forms. Mr. Morel, can you sit your place?
I'll ask you after the. You probably want to sit close by. Yeah.
Okay. We have I think we have a more Mr. Minor. I think we don't have any more person. Citizens want to talk about the number 13. Oh yeah, I think here. Oh, David Romero.
Good evening, Mr. Mayor, council members. My name is Dave Romero, resident of Calexico, California, and a proud employee of Desert Auto Plaza. And I'm here to set a little record straight. We do pay taxes for the city. We do generate a revenue. I had the pleasure to work in the past tent sale at Calexico, which was in the month of March. Amazingly, it was actually during Easter weekend, which a lot of people actually go out with their family from the county. We were able to be fortunate enough to sell 40 vehicles that weekend alone, which started on a Thursday and ended on the Monday. I can even be more specific. Unfortunately, even Monday, we weren't able to do anything just due to the bad weather that particular day. Now, I understand this company is based out of El Centro and actually has employed over 20 people that actually reside in the city of Calexico. So on top of generating revenue for Calexico when it does its tent sales here, it generates income, which then comes back here, and they go out to the stores here, you know, give or take the big one out there, you know, the big supermarket, and so on and so on. Now, in regards to how does it generate, obviously, even though they're stationed in El Centro, it's the Tensil is done in Calexico, there is a business license that they have. And the taxes is actually upped to 8.5 because that's the tax bracket that's here. The only time it's not up when it's a resident that's out of the city, they get taxed at their city tax bracket, but that revenue still stays in this city. With the past two Tensils that they've done, and I'm just going on an average number, we've sold 90 cars at an average of $15,000 per car at 8.5%. That's approximately $1,275 that you're getting per car. If you multiply that by 90, you're making approximately over $117,000 to the city. I'm not so much defending Desert Auto because I'm an employee. I'm more than anything a defender of capitalism and of making Calexico, you know, much better and to have more revenue to help out, to, you know, better out the city. So I strongly recommend to the council to say no to this for that very same reason, and because I strongly believe that it does benefit the city, and it does benefit everybody here. Thank you for your time.
Thank you, Mr. Romero. And I believe next person has Mr. Manuel Yanez.
Good evening again, council members, City of Calexico. That is a really good idea. I understand one of the council members brought this idea into the council discussion today. Well, if you guys want to read up the 10 cells, that is okay. But you have to close the Palmas, and you have to close the Santo Tomas one. Those are 10 cells, too. I don't think it's a good idea to close business coming in, to stop business coming in. I agree with the lady that spoke before here. I believe that we have to encourage business, not to stop the business coming in. If we stop doing that, we start doing that, then many businesses are gonna see Calexico as a town that doesn't allow the encouragement of the business. I just want to make a clarification. I work in construction, and I don't agree with the lady that spoke here before to raise the other issue about the impact fees and building construction fees. I don't agree with that at all. Developers have stopped coming here. That's one of the reasons. We have to encourage business. If we don't do that, we are going to continue in the situation that we are, in the financial situation that we are right now. 10 sales, those are okay, the way that I see it. You have to do something that could be temporary, or you can do it permanently, but you have to decide. You have to make a good decision in order to bring revenue to the city.
Thank you, Mr. Yanez. And now, no more public comments.
I motion not to approve.
Council discussions. Anything that council member to talk?
No, I think we've.
Okay, motion on the floor is Mr. Yanez not to approve it.
Do we have a second? Second that motion.
Second the motion to the next. Mr. Castro.
Is it A or B?
Actually,
we
have
A.
To be.
We're doing separate.
We're going to go separate, so we're going to go to talking about the ordinance number A. So we have to move. We need to motion again.
I mean, a motion not to approve item number A.
Number A, motion approved, not to approve it. The second by Mr. Castro?
Second.
Yeah. Aye.
Yes.
Okay. Do we have a discussion? No?
Ms. Padilla made a good point on bringing the information on how lost sales from our current existing car dealerships compare with the particular 10 sale. And I believe that's what we wanted to have that. I don't know, you, Mr. City Manager, is there a way to get that information or to do a comparison?
I think we had the last time already from the.
Did we?
Yeah, Mr. Leal was brought all the information.
I think the only thing we brought in was the sales revenue from that dealership. But There was some talk just last month about Rogers and Rogers coming into to the city to do one at the movie theater, which is a city-owned property that could, you know, city could gain rent there, and you know, it's. I think a cost-benefit analysis wouldn't hurt if the city wants to do that or has the staff to do that. I'm not sure, but you know, for right now, I mean, how do you look the citizens or the employees in the face? Say, listen, we're running $3 million, but here's a company coming in to do tax money in the city and say, no, you know. And when it comes to tent sales, I mean, Las Palmas, Santo Tomas, that's what they are. They're tent sales. I mean,
you know, in many instances, Mr. Real, you know, businesses that locate in Calexico have to pay fees for fire, have to pay business licenses,
and they do
fire inspection and all the fees because they've got a brick and mortar
they do,
building.
Right? Yeah.
They give back to the community in many ways through recreation and whatnot. Can I finish?
Go ahead.
Thank you. But that's what I'd like to see these tent sales become, permanent businesses. You know, they've been doing tent sales for years now. I recall up to 5-6 years they've been doing it. But it's hit and run. That's my perception. I may be wrong, but we need to continue to support our local businesses that pay those existing sales tax revenues. And as you well know, Walmart is the biggest sales tax revenue in Calexico. Robinson Ford is the second among, you know, if you can count all the other agencies. So when their sales are hurt because of a weekend in Calexico, then that hurts the sales tax revenue for the city as well. Because lost sales, you know, you've got a pie, just like this pie chart here, and once it's cut and there's a big cut in it by a tent sale, then that money could be lost, and you know worst things to worst, you know, the business could go out of sale or out of business, and then it's lost permanently.
Well, we need facts, though.
That's what I'm saying. That yeah. I'd rather have the information that what sales were lost during those times where these dealerships from out of the city come in because I really can't approve this without that information.
Do you want a motion to continue it until we
absolutely, till we get that information.
My motion, and I'll make a motion to continue this till we have the information from the staff.
Do you get information from the State Board of Equalization on that?
Yeah, that's probably who. Yeah, and DMV.
We'd have to do some research on that, correct?
Okay.
Mm-hmm. City Manager, I'd also like to see maybe we can entertain or address the other restrictions that we put on other businesses as well. For example, we also put restrictions on flower shops. For example, like on Valentine's Day and Mother's Day, we do not allow any other flower shops to sell anything on Imperial Avenue, therefore benefiting brick and mortar such as the very strong businesses and successful businesses that we know we have here in Calexico. So I know we have those restrictions, and then I also recall we had restrictions with regard to a lot of us know them as roach coaches, the catering wagons, because we had those along Imperial Avenue, and we also had a lot of complaints about that. So if we're going to be addressing this temporary type of business versus our brick and mortars and our individuals that are established in Calexico, then I think we need to be fair and we need to look at the overall treatment of these temporary type of business.
Okay, then we're going to have all the business, they already pay the sales tax, they have
same
employees,
concept.
So
it's
they
the
kept the
concept.
Business in here, they're going to be hidden, they're going to be hurt by the hit and run beside the economy.
Well, I mean, it's the same concept. I don't understand.
Maybe a person coming in to pay some sales tax, yes, probably. But what about the exit business there, the good faith in their establishing the business in the city of Calexico? They got hurt by the hit and run. They have a pie has a limited.
Let me make a comment, you know. Businesses like Direct Auto Plaza, like Roach Coaches, like Santo Tomas, Las Palmas, they all pay a business license, correct? They all pay a fire inspection fee, correct? They should, but Direct Auto Plaza, I know, has extinguishers inside and has to get an inspection. Actually, they might pay an inspection every time they come in versus once a year. So they pay more in fire inspection fee than a normal business. This mentality that they don't pay rent, they pay upwards of $20,000 to Walmart just for being there 4 days. It's ridiculous, the rent that they pay.
But the citizens didn't see a dime of that.
Actually, they
And they're not going to see a dime of the profit either.
They make tax money.
The profit. Yeah, so the profit is different from sales tax.
Let's get a legitimate study so we can... Let's get a study so we can better make a decision.
There's a motion to continue it till there's a study.
I'll second that, Mr. Real.
Aye.
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 I said no. Nope.
To continue.
Continue.
Did a moratorium for a study. And like
Ms. Adia
says, we never did the study.
It's time for the study. We had the study.
So
we had
I agree
the,
with
we had
that.
The reports.
Actually, let me get the, what is the, we didn't even take the, what's the city manager's recommendation? We didn't even ask.
In our current situation that we find ourselves, we can use any sales tax revenue that is brought in. So the...
But we're going to hurt the sales tax from other business.
Well, we can do the research. We can bring it back. We can bring it back to you. But basically, my recommendation is that we need to bring any type of sales tax sales revenues into the city because it's desperately needed at this time.
I want to ask Ralph because Ms. Lorena Minor made a comment regarding the reduction in the fees, and just I know people have short-term memories, but the reduction in fees was a pilot program for a year, correct? And my question is, it's been a few months now. Have you seen an increase in people come in development? Yes or no, so far?
Well, it's been the same. Basically, what we're looking at are small construction patios.
So it's the same?
Yeah.
Okay. Well, we should probably bring it back to the council to double the fees or at least bring them back to where they were if that's what we need to do. If it's not helping, then it's not helping. That's why it's a pilot program.
Okay, this is out of the agenda.
A futuristic study, knowing
okay,
the future.
We have a number 13B, ordinance okay, we have already voted number A. Okay, we have a 13B, ordinance numbers 1171.
Motion to
ordinance
continue.
Of the City Council of the City of Calexico, California, adding chapter 5.98 to the City of Calexico. Both of the A was, I believe, 421.
Make a motion to continue no. Item number B.
Okay, chapter the City of Calexico Municipal Code prohibiting off-site display and the sale of automobile in the city.
Motion to continue item number B until
second.
The
motion
study.
By Mr. Real, second by Mr. Moreno. Do we have a discussion? If we don't have a discussion, we have a vote.
Aye.
No. 4-1 again. And number 14, funding of the 1 million contribution towards the Calexico Swimming Pool Project. Number 14. Mr. Finley, would you explain on this?
At the past meeting of May 3rd, the council decided to approve an additional $1 million for the swimming pool project towards the construction completion of the swimming pool. It was asked to be brought back and for me to do the research as to the funding sources that were available for this $1 million contribution towards the swimming pool. The only funding sources that qualify for this type of funding is going to be the Measure H bond money, revenue bond money. And basically, there's three options before you as to how we can fund the $1 million contribution. Option one is taking the $1 million from the new fire station construction fund. Option number two is taking the $1 million from the park improvement fund. And option number three is taking $500,000 from the fire station fund and $500,000 from the park improvement fund. So the options are before you, and that is what is being recommended.
City Manager, can we consider again to
who took the money or to borrow the money from the sewer department or water department? Is that something we can consider? Or
this money is that you cannot use enterprise monies to fund this this project.
Okay, so.
I think option three may be something to consider.
We already pulling the $600,000 from the May church bond already. Yeah. So how where are we gonna get the money?
Well, I can tell you the money would be coming. It depends on the option you are taking, either from the fire station fund or from the park improvement fund. Those are the only options or the only funds that are available to be able to fund this project. So it's that's why you have three options, either taking $1 million from the fire station, taking $1 million from the park improvement, or going 50-50 from each one of those funds.
So if we get the money from the park improvement fund, which is we're gonna screw the Cordova Park project?
That would reduce the amount. That would reduce the amount. Yes, that would reduce the amount.
That's my expression. So we should keep on giving the money, but without a money source. What is Mr. Leal?
No. So there is no other option, just the three?
These are the only three options you have, and the only funds that qualify for this type of funding for this type of project is the Measure H Bond Money Fund.
Yeah, we already have a $600,000 take it out. I don't know where we're going to take it out.
Then, Mr. Fendi, is there any option or any new grant coming for the fire department or either for parks, any new, something new, Julia or Rosalinda or someone who works for the city, any staff, no grants available for nothing? No?
And again, a question that comes to mind, I'm sorry, Mr. Castro, were you through? Question that comes to mind, is this money also to be repaid in 3 years? Well, are we cutting ourselves pretty thin?
We are cutting ourselves pretty thin at this point.
We already have a minus budget. How are we going to pay them back?
Well, I see the 50-50 is probably the best option on this.
The 50-50 from the fire and the park?
But that the fire station be built before the park improvement, I think that would be something, you know. Oh, man. Well, if there's no more further discussion, I move that we approve option three.
So we're gonna sacrifice the fire.
I'm just making a motion, Mr. Finance. Kim. Yeah, I'm just making a motion.
Okay. So we're not gonna have money for the Cordova Park then, and the fires. I don't know.
Fire station is more important than the parks.
Yeah. Well, meanwhile, we were waiting for the Mr. Real.
Well,
he ran out for the.
Aren't you gonna say there's a motion on the floor if there's a second?
We didn't have a second yet. So I'd rather go to the Mr. Yanis, speak first. Your motion is still alive.
Okay.
Go to Mr. Yanis, please.
Manuel Yanis again. Council members, Siri Sacalexico. I was raised by my grandma. I spent 18 years living with her. I remember when she told me, when I was doing something wrong, mi hijo, te entra por un oído y te sale por otro. What does that mean? I heard from the administration, they still need money from the Measure H. Measure H and Measure H. There is another fund. There is another solution. No one else can tell you another solution. Measure H, fire station, parks. What's going to happen? What are the intentions? Are you going to lease a property for the new fire station? Where are you going to take your children? Your child, I had a child 10 years old. Where am I going to take him? Should I take him to El Centro Parks? Please, Mr. Friendly, do your work. If you are doing your work, I don't see another cut. I just see for the measure. I don't see another option. I don't see salaries cut. No one's mentioned that. Oh, we are afraid of the employees. We don't see nothing like that. This is a poor town. You have to take a good decision on this. You are the administrator. They are the policymakers. They are the ones that are going to allow you or not allow you to do something. Mr. Friendly, with all respect, do your work. Please, don't let us know that you don't know how to do it. And I was against Mr. Warren. And now, Mr. Friendly, I think I'm going to go against you. Please, do your work. And do it nice. If we are poor, poor town, we have to follow what we are right now. We don't have the income. Don't get the income from Measure H. Please, thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Yanis.
I have a question. The $1 million that we're discussing at this moment was $1 million that the Measure H committee voted to then issue as a contribution. It has nothing to do, the one that we're talking about right now on item 14, has nothing to do with the bonding, right? This is only straight Measure H money, is that correct? A straight Measure H contribution? Is that correct? Because as far as I remember, that's how it was, right? Okay. So my question would be, with regard to this $1 million then, has anyone thought about possibly talking to the school district, and because it's a cash contribution and it's not tied to any bonds or anything, it's not restricted or anything like that, would there be any idea to be able to talk to the school district and say, all right, it's $1 million, maybe we can't give all that to you right now, but Measure H continues to have income coming in, maybe we can work it out with them where we stretch out that $1 million, not having to borrow it from anywhere, but just from the actual source where it was going to come, but not now, maybe in increments for the future.
Okay, first of all, in a way, I agree with Mr. Hurtado, but the thing is, the $1 million, we reserved the money for the, we set aside $1 million from the Measure H money, the former or past administration spent everything. That's why we have issues. But I believe the Measure H, we still have couple hundred thousand dollars every year. We have some couple of $1,000 might come in there. There's some balance coming in. After we pay the bond, we pay the $1.2 million for the police and fire. So we are 2.2, probably we have $400,000 we might have some money. Now we don't have to pay any some of the activities anymore because the swimming pool is going to be there. So we might can make the, some kind of partial payments to probably through the 3-4 years to we can finish the payment to them.
So that what you're stating is take the money from the recreation fund that's being appropriated from Measure H?
Yes. Yeah, because what I'm understanding, the summer program, we adding more money because with no swimming pool, they have some activities there. So we can terminate that activity, the money, we can save the money to pay the school districts.
But at the same time, during that time that we are going to be utilizing the pool for those 3 or 4 months, whatever we are committed to, we have to pay for the maintenance and the and of the pool plus the chemicals plus the lifeguards. So we're going to be stealing from Peter to give to Paul because we'll be able to provide him the money for the construction of the pool, okay. But yet we won't be able to maintain the pool when we need to use it during the summertime because then, the funds won't be available.
Then we might have to sacrifice one of the projects issued by Major H bond instead of affecting here and there. So one project we might can postpone it for a couple of years later. We might can get the money from there to cover this one.
That is part of the options that are before
so
you.
So we already have over $600,000 taken money. So we have to find out which money we're going to spend for that. Yes?
Correct.
So plus this one.
So this money was already allocated for the pool from way back, but because of the overspending, that $1 million is gone, which was spent in 2014-15.
That's correct.
So now, because of the overspending from the prior administration, we have to figure out a way how to get it from either the fire department or the Met Cordova, right? Pretty much. And so I know there was talk about splitting it half and half, which that's also an option, I guess.
We have parts. We don't have a fire station. Take it away from the park, and you guys can get it later. There are parks already existing. These guys need a fire station now.
Well, the fire station is the money is not enough to build a fire station anyways, but it's going to have to be a loan, a triple P to get it done anyways. But, you know, We need both, but we need the fire station. I understand that. And then we're going to need a police station after that. And then.
I believe we have a motion still there. Mr. Moreno was approving option 3. Do you have a second on that?
Which was?
Which is the half and half from the fire, half from the park.
I'll second that.
Okay, second by Mr. Leal. Do you have a discussion?
I mean, there's no.
Okay. Then
there's no easy way to do this. I mean.
Could we say that the first $500,000 that comes back in Measure H revenue go to for the fire department, while the other $500,000 for the, I mean, just the.
But there's nothing left in the Measure H.
Well,
it's depleted.
A million a year, so within a couple of years, you know, I know.
We're just stealing from Peter to pay Paul here.
So we have option 3, it's been on the floor. We're going to have a vote if we don't have any discussion.
Aye.
Is Mr. Romero say aye? Mr. Leal?
Aye.
Mr. Castro?
Aye.
Ms. Castro, aye. Ms. Hurtado?
No.
I said no. So we passed 3-2 to approve it. Okay, now we have item number 15, authorizing interim city manager to sign change order number 1 with R.E. Schultz Incorporation in the amount of $28,000 for the installation of playground equipment, canopy and safety surfacing at Harbor Park and the Rockwood Plaza Park. Motion made by Mr. Castro, second by Mr. Leal.
Yes.
Okay. Is there, we have any discussion? Then we're gonna vote. Mr. Leal?
Aye.
Mr. Castro?
Aye.
Aye.
Ms. Hurtado?
I'm voting no. This change.
Okay, Mr. Montenegro says yes. And Jun Kim said yes. 4-1.
I make a motion to continue the meeting until we're done. It's past 9:30. I make a motion to continue the meeting at 9:30. We're supposed to end the meeting, so make a motion to continue it. Do I have a second?
Sure. Second.
Aye.
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 for that next council meeting?
No, today.
To continue?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, continue.
Motion to approve. I mean, I'm support that motion.
Thank you. The 5-0 to pass. Okay, so we approved what's called the number 15. Number 16, discussion on city funds balance. We have number 16, Lorena Minor.
I thought we already did this.
I think she's not there no longer. Okay, and then we have Ms. Suzanne Mayer, who's discussion on the city fund balance. Mr. What,
Eduardo Gutierrez. Yeah.
Good evening. I think this item was requested by Ms. Hurtado regarding if we have more funds available for projects or for help the general fund operations. And at this point, we are still working on trying to find resources, given the preliminary numbers that we have now, and to planning for budget 16-17. At this time, I don't have a full report to provide regarding if more funds are available. We have very limited funds that can be used to help the general fund. Unfortunately, one of them is Measure H, and other funds are for very restricted for projects. But as our budget evolves, we would make sure to spend whatever fund or resources available instead of using general fund money or Measure H.
Can I ask you for clarification? And I hate my microphone.
Okay. You've stated that we're trying to find resources. Can you please explain what that means?
Okay.
You just said right now that we're still trying to go out there, because when I look at these fund balances, for example, Lorena told us and reminded us that we had a CFD for park funds and for park money to build in that area where the CFD is at. And so what you're telling me, I know that that's where a lot of this problem is that when we're spending money, we need to know that there are those resources when we're spending it, and that our staff is appropriately trained to understand that when they make those choices, they make those choices now at the point of making the expense. Because when you tell us that at this given point, you are still trying to find resources, I don't understand that. We should already know where our resources are according to our budget. So when we look at these fund balances and there's still money in those funds, can we one day have a discussion where those fund balances can be put into play? Because I know that we're not gonna be able to have any grants opportunities here for a while. So if we're not gonna have grant opportunities for a while, we need to know where our cash is. I believe you remember we said that the other time at the other meeting.
Thank you, Mr. Hurtado. Ms. Hurtado, Mr.
Gutierrez? Yes, when I say look for resources, Mr. Hurtado, I'm referring to projects. I'm referring to projects that can be done, but no use or use general fund monies. We have some funds with some developers deposit, but it's for specific projects and maybe impact fees. We want to research to see if we can use this money to help on projects, but again, not for general fund operations. I think the message today that was delivered by Mrs. Meyer was our general fund is almost depleted. It's not enough to cover the current operational expenses. We're talking about salaries and department's operations.
So right now, the fund report that we have, I noticed the fund report. We're still going to have some time before that's complete. Correct? The
exactly.
Fund balance report.
Yes, we projected general fund at this point. It's general fund only.
Okay. When do you think that maybe we can have these fund balances? Because since we're not going to be able to work with grants and we need to know where our cash is, when do you think we can have that? When, as far as, are those actual already? Because it says preliminary.
It's preliminary numbers.
When do you think maybe you'll be where we'll know where our fund balances are?
Ms. Hurtado, I think so. Ms. Meyer was mentioning that we're not going to have a clear number until September, middle of September, because all the money comes in that time.
Is that correct? We won't know our fund balances until September?
Sales tax coming into September 15.
But we're not talking about general fund.
Just sales tax part of the general fund. So we can have a clear number in the September.
No, that's correct. We want to have the final numbers until September.
Yeah.
But we're not talking about general fund at this point. I think your question or request was to find other sources of money.
To know the true fund balances, when would that be able to accomplish that?
Yes, and at this time, we just focus on the general fund because that was the presentation for tonight.
Okay, I believe the Mr. Finley, the CFT bond, we're talking about Rodia, some bond, CFT bond. That one for the maintenance only, no? Not for the constructions.
That is for the maintenance and maintenance of the park and stormwater facility and some minor incidentals.
Yeah, so minor incidental or the maintenance, so which is we cannot use it as a construction. Yeah,
both the park and the stormwater retention system.
Thank you. Okay, so if we have any suggestion, so from the Mr. Eduardo Gutierrez, so what is the suggestion suggesting us?
At this point, I think we hear the recommendations from our consultants. To fund new projects, that's what we're working on. And the solution, the $3 million is a loan just to balance the other fiscal year. In order for the city to continue to build projects to promote, that's what the resources we are looking for, because specific funds are limited for specific projects. And that's the idea that we need to put together with the next budget. You will see the whole city budget, not just the general fund.
So there's no suggestion to find some other resource?
We want to do our best still. Before the final numbers, you're going to get final report.
But like Ms. Hurtado was saying, is we not be able to receive the grant in next probably two, 3 years or more longer, to be screwed by our old grant money, so we are still on the audit. So until we clear all those issues, we cannot get our grant anymore. So we cannot find the money from the grant.
The thing is, we don't have a grant. We have a grant for our parks, but it's been used already. So
we have to find some one way and the others to general fund $60 million.
Yes, basically yes.
Okay, so you're gonna build the idea with the city manager. You're gonna build the idea or the strategy.
Are you gonna build a deer? Build a deer. An idea. Build an idea.
Build the strategy.
Yes, absolutely. This is not the end of the research.
Okay, thank you, Mr. Gutierrez. Okay, it looks like this one is like a potential action items. What are we gonna do with this one? We just receiving as a informational.
Acknowledge receipt.
Okay, we acknowledge they received it. And appointment of the charter committee by council member Hurtado.
What number are we on?
17.
Go ahead.
Okay. 17. Did the audience hear me correctly? Yeah, I think so. Can you hear me? No?
A little better.
I'm very thankful that you actually gave me an agenda item just for this, but I do want to just make sure I state that I wasn't too excited about putting a member in this committee, because I don't believe that our council, especially with the evidence of things that are happening right now, is ready for such a structural change like this. So I wasn't really ready to put anybody in there, but I'd rather nominate my own person than have anybody else put someone in there. So I nominate Mr. Flavio Grijalva for this position.
Flavio Grijalva.
Thank you.
Thank you, Ms. Hurtado. Okay, number 18, consideration of the consolidated city commissions, board of the committees. Ms. I think this is one item from the Mr. Real.
What item?
Consolidation 18?
Number 18,
right?
Yeah.
No, that's 20.
We're on 18.
18.
Consolidation of the.
For some reason on mine it's item number 20. Anyways, so yeah, that's, I mean, it's pretty straightforward.
If we want, we can postpone, we can continue next meeting.
It's a staff recommendation to do this. It's as far as I'm concerned, it's the best thing to do. That it's taking too much staff time, too much time from our committee members, and it's just ridiculous to have 15, 16 different commissions. Gabby can tell you, and so can the city manager.
Looks like they've cut it down to 9.
Yeah.
And I'm all for that.
Make a motion to approve.
Second.
Second. Aye.
Motion to approve it, but we have some little discussion in case of the consolidated. No. How we gonna consolidate it?
It's already there.
They have some both portion. They have a commissioner.
I think Mr. the staff knows what they're doing. And
Mr.
And,
Real, know. If I may, if this could happen at the next election cycle, right? Is that when you would plan to do this? Because
yeah, we need to do that.
At the next election cycle, when you appoint new members and new members come in. So then you
that's fine.
Yeah, but it's going to be so far. When
really?
we just need to find out a way.
For the next, okay, so I make a motion to approve it, and it starts in other words, December 2nd.
December or January?
Aye.
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 Aye. Okay. Yeah, but the thing is too much.
Too many. Okay. All right.
Why
so
not now?
Next.
Did you ask?
Okay.
She voted. Did you give the vote?
Okay,
she
Ms. Hurtado?
No.
No? Okay, so 4-1. Okay, number 19. Award request of the proposal of American National Community Service to provide the loan profile, portfolio services for the City of Calexico housing programs and the authorized interim city manager to sign service agreement with American National Community Service. Motion for approval by Ms. Hurtado.
Second.
I want to thank staff. It's an excellent agenda item. Very well.
Second.
Okay. Second by Mr. Moreno. We have a discussion. If we don't have a discussion, I have something. I'd like to have American National the report for the next council meeting, and also every quarterly report we need to put in the following every quarter report when we receive it.
We will bring that before you next meeting.
Thank you. So say the hi.
Hi.
Mr. Real? Hi. Mr. Moreno?
On this one? Well, I seconded it.
Yeah, yeah.
Hi.
Hi. Okay. Ms. Hurtado? Okay. 5-0. Anonymous. Okay. Number 20. Appointment by mayor and the council members to various commissions, board of the committee. Is any council member ready for a point?
I'm ready.
Yes? Yes, please.
them all together. That way you're not sitting. Business Improvement District, I'd like to be able to appoint Mr. Jesus Escobar.
Which one? The
improvement? Business Improvement District is Mr. Jesus Escobar. My Financial Advisory Board would be Manny Manuel Hernandez. For my Historical Commission, I think that we need new blood in there, and I know that Angel Esparza would be an awesome addition with his research and his positive attitude, so I'll have him there.
But he's have another.
No, he's been removed. Isn't that correct? Yeah. And then
he removed. He cannot be the 1 year.
Yes, he can.
For not showing up, though, he can.
He can.
Well, I don't think that Mr. Esparza would be very dangerous or controversial.
I mean, we have
a historical commission.
He cannot be there.
So I'd like to nominate Angel Esparza for the Historical Commission.
But he cannot be there because he lost.
I would like to nominate Angel Esparza for the Historical Commission. We can discuss that later, his eligibility, Ms. Garcia. And then as far as the Beautification Commission, I'd like to appoint Mr. Escobar. Oh, I forgot his first name.
Gustavo
Escobar for the Beautification Commission. And on my Measure H committee.
I bet Gustavo Escobar, he quit.
I'd like to be able to, he quit wanting to represent you, sorry. But the Measure H committee, I would like to appoint my very dear friend, Mr. Chuy Iniguez. Thank you.
And I'm done.
Okay, thank you. But Ms. Garcia, ignore Ms. Esparza's nomination because it's not allowed. It doesn't matter, this ordinance is not allowed to be there.
Okay. No,
that's either one or not. We don't have any overpower over you, but we cannot to let anybody to against the city ordinance.
It is the most difficult thing to find people to want to serve on these commissions.
Yes, I understand.
And
that.
Now that I have found them, now
yes,
you want
I
to reject
understand.
Them.
I have same issues.
And in order to be able to find someone else, it's going to be a little hard. So,
but it doesn't matter. He said not qualified.
These
one year.
These are community volunteers.
Okay, thank you. Okay, so any council member to have appointments? If not, we're going to go for the informational items.
No, I have give me 1 second. I have a Jose Yepes for Planning Commission. Mm-hmm. Jose Yepes, and then I also have, I had someone apply for the Police Advisory Committee, I don't see his paperwork in here, but he did bring it. Can I wait till the?
Okay, next meeting then.
No. I want to appoint him today. I just need to. I forget his last name though. Let me text him for his last name. Hold on 1 second.
Okay, so we're gonna revisit on that, and we're gonna go to the main wire informational items. Statute report on financial audit. Mr. Gutierrez, number 21.
Hello, Council members. Update on city audit.
I have the name now. I can. Cesar Andres Tafoya for Police Commission.
Czar.
Yeah.
C-Z-A-R.
C-Z-A-R.
Tafoya?
Cesar
Tafoya?
Cesar.
Cesar Tafoya.
It's Cesar.
Czar.
I don't know what kind of language you're using it, but it's okay.
We don't know what kind of language you're using.
Okay, statute report, Mr. Gutierrez.
Yes, good evening. This is an update report for fiscal year 2014-15, And this is updated up to last Friday, May the 13th, 2016. Overall, the city's audit is completed at 75%. And I want to list the areas that will already review it, and they no find any findings so far. Accounts payable, which is one of the biggest areas to review. They put a special attention on expenditures. So. Payroll, inventories, interest payable, and long-term debt. They mentioned they have to do some minor work to complete the revision on account receivable, notes receivable, and the cash. They mentioned minor work, so. And they expect to complete for next week the TDA reports, transit reports, fixed assets inventory, and the depreciation schedules. For a single audit, the review is going well so far. They used to be back next week to complete some revision for the federal dollar amount that has to be reviewed on the single app. And we expect to complete the revision within 3 weeks from now. And hopefully they can provide a report within a month. That's the very expectations.
Thank you.
We're talking about 14, 15.
Thank you. I think we have another one here. You don't have to go back. Department revenue expenditure comparison report. You done yet?
No, Mr. Kim. We don't have that one.
So
we'll bring it back.
Bring back the next meeting?
Yeah, we want to bring back to the next meeting.
Okay. So we have before we have the future agenda, we're gonna.
Mayor, can I ask?
Yes.
I wasn't sure if I had a Measure H appointment, but I do, and I have the name. Can I appoint the person?
Oh, go ahead.
It's David Romero for Measure H.
Who?
David Romero.
David Romero, Measure H.
Measure H.
So he's a person living here.
He's right there.
Yeah. I know those are some questions.
Can you check your pulse? Are you living? Yeah, he's living right now.
Yes, I am.
Okay. Thank you. Okay.
Future agenda item. Can I start?
No, wait a minute. We're gonna talk about the future meeting, the general meeting.
Let's do that just before.
Just before the agenda. Okay. So future agenda.
So future agenda item. I would like to bring to the council the catering trucks. I believe that, you know, that could be cities like Mexicali, El Centro, they're Imperial, they're doing these catering truck events where it's 2-3 trucks. And I mean, we have catering trucks already in Calexico. They just go to the high school and certain spots, but they don't really park, you know, in residential areas and stuff like that, which I'm not sure if it's allowed or not, but to promote business, I would like to bring it to the council and see if the council wants to approve catering trucks. And while we're at it, I know that flower shops were brought also. At one point, they were banned from being. But you know, I don't. If they have a city license, you know, I don't see why not. Just you know, we need to kind of bring in business. So
okay. I like. The first one, which
catering
trucks. Mm-hmm. Many cities have certain areas of town where they congregate.
Can, correct.
However, the flower shop, I think we need to look at that a little more.
Okay.
Because we only have two or three, and then they make their monies on Valentine's
two, three flower
and Mother's
shops.
Day. And then the rest of the year, it's, you know, mm-hmm. So I just focus on that.
Okay.
And I would also see if we want.
So let's do the catering trucks first.
First, right.
Okay. So I have concurrence on the catering trucks.
Sure.
Let's
you got
get that
me.
Going.
Okay, Mr. Leal,
catering
trucks.
Future agenda items.
Approvements. Approving the catering trucks.
Correct.
And Mr. Leal and Mr. Moreno was
second, right.
Seconded. Okay, concur.
I have one item, Mr. Mayor.
Yes, please.
I'd like to see if we can direct staff to look at holding perhaps a workshop with a number of advisory commissions, specifically Business Improvement District, Economic Development, on what our plans are as a city and as a business, and perhaps even as a Chamber of Commerce, for the next couple of years, 3 years, looking at the expansion of the downtown port of entry and how we can promote that.
One other thing, now that you bring that up, that I had talked to a few commissions, were the possibility, John, of the council maybe having a joint meeting with the bid and with the finance, and almost like a mandatory joint meeting once a year. I think that might also be.
And I think in the summer we can do this like in the summer, yeah. When you know there's a little downtime, people can meet and
downtime for you, bro.
No, it's downtime for others, you know. But I got to work. But to have a workshop and make a strategic plan, if you will, just for businesses in this area, because I think what we're doing is we're hitting and missing a lot of things, and I think we need to work collaboratively.
Also, we I know we brought the closure of Rockwood and we kind of it kind of
that
died
can be
gone.
Part of the discussion.
You know that okay. So let's add the Rockwood.
Right, and how it relates to the expansion of the downtown port. That's all I have.
In my case, Julia Osuna, she always sent me an email related to the meetings. So I think. You sent that email to everybody, right, Julio?
No, I don't receive any downtown. I don't receive any, you mean INS meeting?
Yeah.
The new parliamentary meeting?
No, I'm not sure about that. But the majority of the meetings I received
Oh, you're talking about the BID meeting?
Yeah, BID meeting.
Yeah, BID meeting, I think, to go to all the council members. Yeah. Okay, so workshop for the improvement of the business, and the other one is catering truck approvals. Okay. Thank you. And before we close this, join the meeting, are we?
One more item over here.
Ms. Hurtado?
Did you want the item?
We get two, right? I don't care. Tomorrow, there's going to be a meeting. The Department of Justice has secured a time and location for the release of the Collaborative Reform Report, which is the COPS report. That will be a public meeting May 18th, tomorrow at 11 o'clock at the LECC facility, 2417 La Boucherie Road. What I would like to ask is that in the next meeting, this council be have an agenda item so that this COPS report, which will be providing in detail what exactly occurred in our police department. What exactly is it that we were facing during that period of time? It will be an independent study from the COPS program, which tries to identify the problems with the community and tries to solve them and provide recommendations for solutions, focusing on community servicing. So I believe that this community has been waiting for these results for a really long time, so if we could have that item. The other item that I really, truly, sincerely believe that we need is some sort of refresher or training course for all these individuals that you just mentioned, Mr. Moreno, which are the financial commissions, your EDC, your finance review, your bid. I in all these conversations, and I know a couple of you that are in this audience know so, we've seen a lot of lack of harmony in the knowledge. And just today I heard that we hadn't had any presentation of information, but my gosh, there's so much online. And so I think that maybe some kind of a refresher course or a workshop that will help these individuals from these commissions understand the full big picture of really what it is that's happening here. Because like today, we're talking mostly about preliminary results or rather closer to final with regard to general fund. But in order to really realize and have a skillful set of information to apply to a solution is knowing your big picture. And right now, I believe that many of these commissioners don't know the big picture. And so I'm going to recommend that we have some type of a workshop because it's been so crazy. And just to kind of help them to kind of, you know, present to them where they can ask their own questions and feel comfortable.
Mr. Henley, do we have a, I think, a workshop schedule? We have a training schedule for all the commissioners.
We have ethics training currently, but we can schedule something.
I'm interested in what Ms. Hurtado said as far as and how, but at the same time, how much it would cost? Because I know the council had a team working built workshop that cost the city thousands and thousands of dollars, maybe like $10,000-$20,000, and yeah, we didn't do too good with that. So, actually, I was there. I was there. What are you talking about? We were all there. Well, yeah, we're at the community center and here. I mean, if you're gonna take the training, yeah. So, the training it probably said talk to your city manager and to the rest of your council.
Second on Ms. Hurtado.
Thank you.
Sorry.
Thank you. Okay, so before we adjourn the meeting, we're gonna postpone it, change the meeting date here. June 7th to the move to June 8th. Do we have election a day. Council? The election day. Because June 7th is Tuesday election day.
Election day.
So we have to have a move the meeting to the next day.
Are you going to have a Wednesday. Big campaign party?
Doesn't really matter. So we're going to have the June 8th, move to the June 7th to the June 8th.
I'm going for that.
Okay, well, Mr. Moreno, Mr. Castro?
Motion to approve.
Yeah, motion to approve.
Motion to adjourn.
So that
oh, yeah, yes,
when
I.
When was the regular meeting?
It's a first Tuesday in June.
Next day.
The first Tuesday in June is election. So okay. We'll move it to the Wednesday.
Motion to adjourn.
Motion to adjourn to 10:05.